Well, Michigan and Minnesota, little brown jug again. Michigan trying to dodge all kind of negatives that seem inevitable. Minnesota has to bounce back from a gutting home loss when they gambled and threw the pick against Northwestern.
Michigan has beaten Minnesota four of the last 5 years. Payback as hell. I'm coming back. Minnesota by two touchdowns. They'll get this one.
Yeah, I just keep thinking that Michigan's going to turn the corner, and they just don't. I'm very shocked by the way their defense has played this year. I'm going with Minnesota as well. I think Minnesota gets back up after a disappointing loss last week. I got Minnesota here.
Mm-hmm. Get that jug. Michigan fans would like to fill that jug with like a fine cognac and just drink it all down and just forget the season. Come back in 2009.
You're right.
Three.
Where the battle for the little brown jug will be fought between Michigan and Minnesota. It's the second oldest trophy in college football. Michigan has dominated, though, in the past few decades. We welcome you to ESPN's College Football presented by Cars.com. And it's almost a flip-flop of what we're used to seeing. Minnesota is bowl eligible. Michigan has been struggling. They've lost five in a row and are short of their first losing season since 1967. Hi, Pam Ward here, along with Ray Bentley. And Michigan also is not going to get to a bowl this year for the first time in a very long time. So what are they playing for?
Well, they're playing for pride, Pam, and the love of the game, and also to expedite the transition under Coach Rodriguez. Right now, I think they're behind schedule. Now, Minnesota, Tim Brewster told us, they are ahead of schedule, and they are playing for a lot here today. They're looking at a New Year's Day bowl game if they can keep rolling.
It has been a tremendous turnaround for Minnesota. Last year, they were 1-11 overall, 0-8 in the Big Ten, and they are ready to battle for the little brown jug. And there it is. They have been playing for it since 1909. Michigan, as we said, has really dominated as of late, as they have won two in a row and 35 of 38. Rich Rodriguez, maybe not exactly what he thought he signed up for when he came over from West Virginia, Ray.
Well, he said he really didn't look into it as deeply as one might expect, assumed some things, but he also said things are in place where he can get this thing turned around.
Tim Brewster has been really magical in his second season as the head coach. We are underway. Minnesota gets the football first. Troy Stottermeyer, a true freshman, one of 10 true freshmen who have played for the Gophers this year, is ganged up on at the 20-yard line, brought that opening kickoff back 12 yards. Minnesota's offense is run by its sophomore captain, Adam Weber, a second-year starter and really having a terrific season. Last week, he accounted for 380 of Minnesota's 390 offensive yards in the loss to Northwestern.
Yeah, and you see that number of interceptions, just four. He threw 19 last year, but he really grew a lot during those hard times, shall we say, and it's paying off for him here as a sophomore.
His favorite target is number seven, Eric Decker. By far the leading receiver on this team, and the handoff to DeLeon Eskridge, another one of those true freshmen, picked up 3 yards. Impact players for the Minnesota Golden Gophers. Ben Kuznia is starting to get more balls thrown his way, especially with Eric Decker getting double and triple teamed at time. Eskridge, you just saw him, the true freshman running back. He got the first carry, and then there's Eric Decker, so talented.
Yeah, he's an amazing football player. 73 catches on the year, leading the Big Ten, and they will find all kinds of different ways to get him the ball and move him around in formations.
He's caught 37% of the throws completed this year. That one goes to Stottermeyer, and he picks up nothing. Donovan Warren on the stop. At the top of your screen, you will see the offensive members, or the offensive starters for Minnesota, scrolling by. The Golden Gophers averaging 27 points per game, and their running offense really has suffered since they have hit Big Ten play. And now they're facing a 3rd and 6. And Weber throws that in the direction of Kuznia, a 3 and out for Minnesota, as the Golden Gophers will be forced to punt on their first possession.
Great coverage by Michigan on that. And really, Adam Weber had nowhere to go with the football, had to throw it away. A good start for the Wolverines, and that's so important for them right now. reeling the way they are on the five-game losing streak, to come out and get a three and out to right off the top. That's a good start for the Wolverines.
Michigan gives up more points than anybody else in the Big Ten, about 31 per game. Justin Cusick's first punt towards Martavius Odoms, who is very dangerous when he touches the football. Last week he had a career-high 45-yard kick return. That one only went for six on the punt return. It was a 46-yarder by Cusick. The Michigan offense about to come out, and they are starting Nick Sheridan at quarterback because Stephen Threet, their regular starter, suffering from concussion effects, and we won't see him today, so it's Sheridan's turn.
And Sheridan started against Utah on opening day for the Wolverines, and then Threet took over about week three as the starter, so Sheridan get another crack at it.
He's played in five games this year. Really, his playing time has gone down since that Notre Dame game, and they have Sheridan throw it right away to Odoms. And he gets it up close to the 40-yard line, picking up six on first down. Sheridan, the redshirt sophomore from Saline, Michigan. His dad used to be a defensive assistant for the Wolverines. And again, making just his second start of the year.
And I spoke with him before the game. He seemed calm, confident, and excited about this opportunity. But now they got Miner in the backfield.
They'd like this direct snap play to Miner, and Minnesota snuffs it out beautifully, dropping him for a two-yard loss. Trey Simmons coming up from his corner spot to help out. Michigan's impact players on this offense: Brandon Miner, you already saw him with the direct snap. He has four 100-yard games this season. Sam McGuffey, he has been dinged up a little bit, but they say he is healthy and ready to go. And Odoms can do a lot of things.
Yeah, he's their leading receiver and probably the most explosive player that they have on the perimeter.
Now Michigan facing a third and five.
You see him check over here. Calvin McGee, the offensive coordinator, he makes these play calls when they check at the line.
And they're not going to get it off in time.
Michigan, their first time out.
But just before the play clock expired, a timeout has been taken. So Rodriguez has a little chat with Sheridan. We're coming back to a third and five. Today's game is being broadcast on ESPN in high definition. You look at the University of Minnesota campus, a few miles from the Metrodome. We had some snowfall in the area yesterday. We're very glad to be inside. It's about 35 degrees outside, 72 degrees inside, and a third and five for the Wolverines. Sheridan lops one upfield, and it is caught. What a great catch by Greg Matthews. Put out the one arm and gathered it in for a 28-yard gain.
Oh, what a throw by Sheridan, and then the effort by Matthews making the one-hand catch. Look at him hand fighting with the right hand, and then the left hand, he reaches it out and pulls it in. And now Michigan going to that hurry-up tempo game after a big play.
Matthews, the top returning receiver for Michigan this season. Brandon Miner with the carry, picked up about a yard for the Wolverines. Starting lineups scrolling across the top of your screen for Michigan. You see Sheridan in there. If you're just joining us, Stephen Threet is not even dressed today, will not play because he suffered a concussion in last week's loss at Purdue. Second and nine for the Wolverines. The blitz coming. Sheridan throws it incomplete towards Daryl Stoneham, a true freshman. Marcus Sherrills was on the coverage. Sherrills, a former walk-on, his brother Mike was a captain of the Gopher team a couple years ago. Minnesota starting defense. Now you can check them out across the top of your screen, including Willie Vandesteeg, who really has been a stalwart on the defensive line. Stephen Threet, there he is in street clothes and doing some other work today.
Yeah, he just had a hangover from that concussion, headaches throughout the week, didn't really practice, and they made the decision that he could not perform out here today.
Originally went to Georgia Tech, but never played there. Third and nine. Minnesota was offsides on the play. Sheridan with the throw. It goes incomplete, but Deion Hightower, number 44, jumped the play.
Ted Roof, the defensive coordinator, dialed up a blitz, and Hightower
offside. Got... number 44 on the defense. Five-yard penalty. Repeat third down.
Hightower got a little over-anxious. And I know where he's coming from. You get up in there and they call your number to bring a blitz on a critical third down. Here he is. He's just going to get up there a little too quick, and bam, you can see obviously offsides. I'm almost surprised it wasn't blown dead with the old unimpeded to the quarterback.
Hightower second of Minnesota with seven tackles for loss this season. Minor and McGuffey in the backfield. McGuffey is number two. To Sheridan's right, he's out on the pass pattern. The ball is almost picked off by Kyle Ferrett, got in the way of Daryl Stoneham. And this Minnesota team really has feasted on turnovers this year.
And Nick Sheridan's a little bit late with this throw. It's going to be a skinny post route. He should, bam, that ball should have gotten, he should have gotten rid of it quicker. His eyes were outside, and he didn't see it until a little bit late. That's a throw when the safeties are back like that. You've got to stick it in there before they can come up and make a play.
Instead, they have to settle for the 44-yard field goal attempt by Casey Lapata. His career long is from 50. And this one from 44 goes through. So Michigan, helped out by that long pass to Greg Matthews, gets on the board first. Got to be a nice sigh of relief for Coach Rodriguez as his team goes up 3-0. When we come back, the dynamic duo from Minnesota, Adam Weber at quarterback, Eric Decker, the receiver.
More questions.
ESPN's College Football is presented by Cars.com, where confidence comes standard.
We are at the University of Minnesota, actually at the Metrodome, and that's Goldie the Gopher pregame, getting everybody all made up. The students painting their faces. They also made up some signs. And Coach Tim Brewster was hanging around with them as well yesterday. And it's a gold out today. They encourage all the fans to wear gold. All the coaches have gold on, except for Ted Roof, the defensive coordinator, who's very relieved not to have to wear his electric yellow shirt, as he called it today. Lapata had the field goal. Gingell kicking off for Michigan, who lead 3-0. Jay Thomas collects it at his 5. Gets it out to the 25-yard line after a 20-yard return. Brandon Heron with the stop. Tim Brewster, the second-year head coach for the Golden Gophers, getting involved in all aspects of his program.
Goldie, you got your game face on? Huh, Goldie? You ready to go, Goldie?
Yeah.
Good. All right, everybody up. Everybody come here. Everybody up. Right here. Here we go. Everybody up. Let's go. Let's go. Get your hand in here. Get your hand in here. We are Minnesota on 3. We are Minnesota. Loud, let's raise the roof. 1, 2, 3.
We are Minnesota!
All right.
Weber with the throw falls incomplete, looking for his tight end, Jack Simmons. And we visited with Coach Brewster yesterday. And he certainly has changed this program around, obviously. They lost 6 games last year by a total of 23 points. They were 1-11 overall. But very positive guy, Ray.
Yeah, he was. And I loved his message about being a hard-nosed, physical football team. He said that's what he demands. That's what he expects out of his players. He says, we do that, the scoreboard will take care of itself. To me, that's bottom-line football.
And he really is all revved up about getting Minnesota football back up to its previous high level. Weber, who led Minnesota in rushing last season, holds on to it and picks up 3. Donovan Warren with the stop. So the big turnaround for Tim Brewster, his team 7-2 with losses only to Ohio State and Northwestern. And Duke, a terrific turnaround for them. And what about Jerry Kill going from Southern to Northern Illinois and doing great things?
Yeah, you see that's a testament to coaches coming in and really making their imprint immediately. And on the other side, Rich Rodriguez, he's still waiting to make that imprint.
Yeah, going the other way for a Michigan team that won 7 games last year and only have 2 wins so far this season.
Ball start. Number 73 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. repeat third down.
Jason Menke moving prematurely for the Gophers sets him back 5 yards.
That's one of those unforced errors, a self-inflicted penalty. That when we spoke to the offensive coordinator, Mike Dunbar, he keeps track of those things. He's got a formula that, you know, if you hit certain numbers on things, you're going to win. Well, that wasn't good. That's a negative. That's a minus in that formula.
Could have been an unforced error for his team. Dunbar spent a few years at Northwestern. This is his second year with Minnesota. Eskridge gets the pass and goes about 7 yards. We get our first update of the day from Reese Davis. Hey, Reese.
Hello, Pam. Glad to talk to you on a Saturday. Taco Bell studio update taking us to the greater Chicagoland area. Ohio State, Northwestern. Terrell Pryor sending out his heart line. Bryan doesn't quite get into the end zone, but shortly thereafter, Beanie Wells would pay it off, put the Buckeyes up 7-0. But the Cats are on the move right now, deep in Buckeye territory. It's on ESPN2.
Thank you, Reese. Northwestern with the win against Minnesota here last week. Odoms fields the punt at his 28 and is dropped immediately. A great tackle by Broderick Smith, a true freshman receiver, making his mark on special teams. Michigan up by 3, has the football when we come back. Adam Weber talking to his head coach, Tim Brewster. Minnesota has yet to pick up a first down in 2 possessions so far and find themselves trailing to Michigan 3-0. Sheridan hands it off to Miner. And Miner picks up 2. Some real tough losses in the Big Ten last week, including Michigan. They're up with 26 seconds left, but here's the old hook and lateral. Desmond Tardy going to go the distance. Michigan falls 48-42. So they are assured of their first losing season since 1967. And their bowl appearance streak ends at 33, the longest such streak in the nation.
And Coach Rodriguez said that was a really tough one. They had a 24-hour rule. You got to get rid of it.
On 2nd and 8, that ball is thrown behind the intended receiver, Savoy. And it's incomplete, and this is astounding. Michigan on the cusp of doing something it has never done in 129 years of football, and that's lose 8 games in a season.
And that's just amazing and mind-boggling to a lot of the U of M faithful. They knew there would be a transition, and they knew that, you know, they only had one starter returning on offense, and they thought the defense would be able to hang in there and keep them in some games, but nobody expected them to go 2-7.
It's only the 4th year in 129 years that they've even lost 7 games. 3rd and 8 as it gets loud. Sheridan decides to hold on to it, and Hightower gets on top of him. 5 yards downfield, Willie Vandesteeg also in on the tackle for the Gophers.
This is just good hustle and pursuit by the Gophers defense. You're going to see Vandesteeg. He's a defensive lineman rushing, and then he's going to release off it. Right there, he gets off the block, gets a trip up, and then Hightower comes out of his zone drop to close on the quarterback, and they stop him 3 yards short of the sticks.
Another punt for Zoltan Mesko. 3rd year as a starting punter for Michigan, and they fake it. Mesko running towards the sticks, and he gets the first down. How about that? Rich Rodriguez pulling something out of his hat.
A gutsy call by Coach Rodriguez back inside his own 40-yard line, but they see that they think they can block and then outrun the contain. And you see that that's Vandesteeg chasing down Mesko, and Mesko wins that foot race. And boy, from the blocking, to me, it almost looked like Mesko made an executive decision there. Didn't look like they had set up to block that. I think he might have just taken off.
How about that? He is the best punter in the Big Ten, and he showed some speed that time on 4th and 3 inside in their own territory. Michigan gets the first down. That pass complete to Greg Matthews. Matthews picks up 4 for the Wolverines. But you got to figure, Michigan, here's a team that is, as we mentioned, 2-7. They really have nothing to play for. You talk about pride playing for next year. So why not do something like that?
Yeah, it's time to pull out all the stops and do different things and try to, you know, get some momentum going, turn things around.
2nd and 7. Miner, big through the hole. Brandon Miner finally taken down by the leg inside the 15. Kyle Theret got him. That's a 40-yard gain for Michigan.
And he ran it to the left side, and I think that's where Michigan is much stronger, running to the left behind McAvoy and Ortman. And here he is. You're going to see him. He just breaks that tackle right there. Van de Steek can't quite get him. The linebackers had overcommitted, and Miner has a burst now. He can just hit it and get it when he gets a gap like that.
Well, he crushed Minnesota last year running for 157 yards against the Gophers. They go right back to Miner, and he is wrapped up, but picked up three more yards.
Brandon Miner has really established himself as the main ball carrier. This is his fourth start in a row, and he's really churned it up in those starts. Had 155 yards rushing last week as Michigan goes to a diamond formation up top.
With the four receivers to the right of Nick Sheridan. He throws it immediately to Odoms, and he loses the football. Minnesota, which has feasted on turnovers all season. Lee Campbell jumped on the ball, but they're saying it's still Michigan football.
I think the ground causes this fumble. Right there, you see Stoneham misses the block. Tremaine Brock comes up and makes the tackle. And I want another look at this, because I think that ball was out. They're going to replay this.
It's under review.
Brock knocks it out right here. You see him, his hands on the ball. It's starting to come loose. And the knee didn't hit that quickly. And Lee Campbell comes up with the recovery. But I think this is going to be ruled a fumble on the field. Well, it's already been ruled a non-fumble on the field. But I think the booth is going to change that.
Odoms with the catch lost 3 yards on the play, but Minnesota has been so terrific. First in the nation with 26 forced turnovers this year.
Jim Kimmerling is our replay official today. You see the ball not in full possession, knee not down, ball's out. I think Mr. Kimmerling is going to overturn this one. It's going to be Gopher football. And again, Minnesota has a great penchant for forcing turnovers, in particular in this area.
26 forced turnovers this year. They have translated that into 99 points. The Gopher defense under first-year coordinator Ted Roof. And he emphasizes takeaways. He has what he calls Takeaway Tuesday, special drills set up to strip footballs, among other things. And it really has paid off for this defense.
Yeah, and that's something that every team across the nation works on, Pam. But it's a matter of emphasis. And Ted Roof, he looked at the talent that he had here, and he said, we're going to have to be really good at this. And they started emphasizing it and preaching it to their team way back in spring last year. And the guys bought in. And that's when the guys buy in, that's when things start to happen for you.
So we wait for the decision upstairs. The evidence, again, has to be very solid in order for them to overturn the call on the field, which was that it was a fumble.
You know, Pam, that last replay we saw, I think, Will, is ample evidence to overturn this.
Now, if Michigan does hold on to the football, here we go.
It was determined that the runner had fumbled the ball before it was blown dead.
So Minnesota gets yet another turnover. Now 27 forced turnovers on the season. That is number one in the bowl subdivision.
Tremaine Brock took it away, and Lee Campbell covered it. And Rich Rodriguez is saying, man, we had momentum. We were driving. And once again, a self-inflicted wound.
So Minnesota gets the football at the 17-yard line. There's Ted Roof, has done a spectacular job taking over this defense. And on first down, Stoudemire gets close to the 20 as we get an update from Reese Davis.
Pam, Mac Brown said he was fresh out of motivational ploys. They didn't bury a football or call in anybody to talk to the Longhorns after their loss to the Red Raiders last week against Baylor. They just went back and hit during practice, let Colt McCoy throw touchdown passes to Quan Cosby as McCoy's 24th touchdown toss, and the Horns up by 7 at home early.
Thank you, Reese. Mac Brown has had a terrific influence on Tim Brewster, the head coach
at Minnesota. He cited him several times yesterday in our meetings with him.
Spent 12 years with him.
Second and eight. Weber going up top to Decker, and Decker gets hit. The ball is incomplete. Charles Stewart coming up to give him a lick.
Yeah, Stewart playing over the top. They're going to have a way to double-team Decker throughout the day. So they've got him covered on the edge, a little man-to-man from Donovan Warren. And then over the top comes Charles Stewart to lay a blow on Eric Decker, who came into this game a little banged up.
As I say, he has been banged up this entire season. Minnesota still struggling offensively. Weber flicks it out, completes it, but well short of the first down to Jack Simmons, a tight end. Both Weber and Simmons' father played for the University of Minnesota, and they actually beat Michigan back in 1977, something Minnesota has not been able to do very often. Minnesota three possessions now and three and outs.
And give the Michigan defense all the credit right now. They are covering up the receivers, and Adam Weber has had nowhere to throw the football.
Cusick in for another punt, his third of the day. Odoms runs up on it and picks his way into Gopher territory. Terrific starting position for Nick Sheridan and company, thanks to the 13-yard return by Odoms on a 39-yard punt by Cusick. ABC kicks off its coverage of college football today with regional action. Joe Pa and number 3 Penn State take on Iowa in the pursuit of their unbeaten season. Others get Oklahoma, Texas A&M, or Clemson, Florida State. College football on ABC at 3:30 Eastern. Check your local listings for the game in your area. First down now from the 49 of Minnesota. Michael Shaw gets it from Sheridan and picks up a nice 7-yard gain.
And a big part of this Michigan running attack is an east-west type game. You'll see the backs totally turn their shoulders perpendicular to the line of scrimmage. And then they'll head to that edge, and they're looking for that offensive line to build a wall, and then they cut up inside that wall.
Shaw, a true freshman from Trotwood, Ohio. A lot of youngsters on both sides of the football in this game. Odoms is a true freshman and picks up the first down. Got 9 on that. Tremaine Brock made the stop. Michigan and Rich Rodriguez coming in reeling. Losers of 5 straight ball games, but so far so good in this game. You take away the fumble, and they played very, very well.
They're dominating the line of scrimmage right now, Pam. That's the difference in this game.
Another first down for the Wolverines. Sheridan hanging on to it. And he gets all the way down close to the 25-yard line. 8 more yards for the Wolverines. Deion Hightower made the stop for Minnesota.
This offensive line for the Wolverines has been under scrutiny, under the microscope. Just one returning starter, Stephen Schilling, the right tackle. And due to injury, they've had to work a lot of kids in. And now as you get later in the year, all of a sudden you've got a bunch of guys that can play, that have been in there, and they'll rotate them through and keep them fresh, and they're winning up front right now.
They've used 5 different offensive line combinations because of various injuries. Second and 2, Sheridan hangs on and gets close to the first down, a little bit short from that mark. Another big hit, Van de Stieg in on the play for Minnesota. And everyone was curious how Michigan would respond. Would they indeed quit on the season? Rich Rodriguez said repeatedly, especially Monday in a press conference where he got a little bit testy, I would say. Yeah. That he said, we don't have quitters. We want guys coming out. They're going to work hard and continue to play Michigan football.
And he put that challenge to his team early in the week. And he said they responded in practice.
Third and 1. Minor sticks it up in there. Minnesota comes in to get him right away. All dependent on the spot. Lee Campbell, the middle linebacker, getting in there. His first year as a middle linebacker for Minnesota. And from that spot, it is short.
And here he watched the cut by Brandon Miner. He's going to stick the foot in the ground right there and turn it upfield. But a great job of holding the point by the Golden Gopher defense and not letting Miner push the pile at all. Once contact was made, he threw it in reverse, and not because he wanted to.
Michigan coming up that short. Do you go for it here?
I think you do. You got nothing to lose. You're a 2-7 football team. You got 6 inches to make. Make a statement, go for it, and get to keep the drive going. That's what I would do.
Sheridan talking to Rodriguez, who apparently didn't even think about LaPata coming out to try the field goal. They have converted on a fake punt on a fourth down today. And now just fourth and inches.
This quarterback sneak territory right here. Michigan late getting a player out.
Minnesota really stacking up the box, but Sheridan gets the push and the first down for the Wolverines. Now 2-for-2 on fourth down.
Good surge by the offensive line behind David Molt, the center number 50. If you're going to run an effective quarterback sneak, your center has to win that battle.
Molt has started every game as a redshirt freshman out of Lamont, Illinois. Ray already mentioned, there's a good look at David, that Stephen Schilling is the only returning starter on that offensive line. First down from the 22 now for Michigan, leading 3-0. Sheridan hanging on to it. Minnesota offsides yet again. Have to see if they were drawn off, but a Golden Gopher clearly was over the line of scrimmage prematurely. That's a 6-yard gain. John O'Neill, our
offside
referee.
Number 98 in the defense. 5 yards from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
Eric Small, former junior college player, jumping.
Michigan has totally dominated this series here in Minneapolis. They have never lost in this building. They've won 13 in a row and 26 of the last 28 in Minnesota.
Including 5 years ago when they came from way down to beat Minnesota here on a Friday night. Otis doesn't hang on to it. It's an incomplete pass. Tremaine Brock was closing on him, and I think Odoms knew that.
Yeah, he took his eye off the ball because Brock was in his sight, his vision, and then he got hit late, got rolled up a little bit.
Odoms limping off. He's had a terrific season.
You see him, his eyes obviously went up to Brock, but now there's some question on whether or not that ball is a live ball, and that's when Odoms gets hit from a pursuing lineman coming down the line of scrimmage trying to get in there and make a hit. I think that was Juwan Edwards. And the crowd here wants a late hit, and they might have a case.
Odoms being attended to. Odoms today already with 3 catches, so he has set a new Michigan freshman record with 39 receptions on the season, breaking Steve Breston's mark.
And you see right there, that was the end of it there. I take it back. That was actually a different player, Steve Davis, who came hustling in, not Juwan Edwards. But when the ball is thrown laterally, you tell your team, you go run after that football. If it hits the ground, you go get it. Let the officials determine whether or not it was a lateral. And it looks like Odoms is shaking it off a little bit. Nice numbers for him, the leading receiver for the Wolverines.
And those 39 catches, again, a new Michigan freshman record. Second and 5. Tony Clemens now in as a receiver with Odoms on the sideline. Sheridan throws it out to his fullback, Boundros. Kyle Therrett, though, was on the coverage. Good pressure from Lee Campbell. Sheridan had to scramble to get the throw off.
Sheridan just forced that one in there. He had really no other choice. Great coverage on the play from Therrett.
Brings up 3rd and 5. We are inside a minute in the first quarter. This Metrodome crowd starting to make some noise, egged on by the band.
This is a loud building, I'll tell you.
Not a great building for football, but it does get noise, that's for sure. Miner is next to Sheridan, who calls a timeout.
Michigan, their second charge timeout.
That's the second time they've had to do this.
We will take a timeout as well. Michigan facing a big third and five when we return.
I got you.
Welcome back to Minneapolis. Minnesota has not run one play yet in Michigan territory. Michigan about to run its 13th on the Gopher side of the field on third and five. Sheridan going into the corner of the end zone, and the ball tipped away at the last instant by Trey Simmons. Ball intended for Greg Matthews.
And you can run as many plays as you want in somebody else's territory, and if you don't score, in particular touchdowns, it's really deflating as opposed to being a positive. And you see right there a nice movement by Matthews to turn and find the football, but Trey Simmons was all over the play. Simmons leading the Gophers with four interceptions, returned one for a touchdown last week against Northwestern.
He had two picks last week. J.C. LaPata in from 35. He has hit from 44. And it's 6-0 Michigan. Could be a whole lot worse for the Gophers. They are only down 6-0. They have zero first downs on their own. We're back in Minneapolis. That's out in the parking lot. And that is not being used to cook food, but rather to keep the folks warm, because again, it's in the mid-30s outside. So Minnesota people are tough, but it's good to be inside.
Throw another log on that fire.
Absolutely. Michigan up 6-0. Rapata with a couple of field goals. Stoudemire gets it for Minnesota. Breaks a couple of tackles. Good effort as he gets it up to the 33-yard line. Michael Williams with the stop on a 30-yard return. Last week for Minnesota, it was homecoming at the Dome. Northwestern was in town, and boy, Adam Weber wants this one back off Eric Decker's hands. It finally bounced into Brendan Smith's arms, and he returns it 48 yards with 12 seconds left. Northwestern wins it 24-17.
A disheartening loss for this Minnesota team. You got to wonder, are they suffering from a hangover right now?
They have not gotten a first down yet today. Eskridge with the carry. Obiezie with the stop, a 4-yard pickup. Minnesota now 24 total yards, zero first downs as the first quarter comes to a close. Perhaps it is a bit of a hangover, but Tim Brewster fortunate that his team is only down 6-0 to Michigan, which has pretty much lived on Minnesota's side of the field in the first quarter. Coming back to the second quarter, the Gophers trailing the Wolverines 6-0. Spectacular weekend it was in the Big Ten, not for these two guys, but every Big Ten game was decided in the final minute, including two game-winning field goals. And Minnesota losing in the final minute to Northwestern on the interception return. Michigan falling on the Purdue hook and lateral. First play of the second quarter, not much going on at all for Eskridge. In fact, gets nothing.
Missed his cut. He had a cutback as we look at the Big Ten standings. And you know, you mentioned about those games being won in the last minute, and it's a 60-minute game in the Big Ten. There's no doubt about that. A lot of parity, I think, across the board, although Penn State is certainly head and shoulders above everybody else. You can make an argument Ohio State is maybe above a little bit, but otherwise, it's on any given Saturday, any one of these teams can beat it out the other.
Five teams technically still alive for the Big Ten title, but Penn State can clinch at least a tie with a win coming up today against Iowa. On third down, and that one was thrown in the general vicinity of Ben Kuznia. Eric Decker has only been thrown to once in this game, has not brought it in. He hurt his ankle against Northwestern last week. You have to wonder if that is a factor. And now Minnesota is a perfect 0-for-4, or imperfect, 4 possessions and 4 punts.
0 first downs, 0 explosive plays. Their longest play on the day, 7 yards, and they have yet to take a deep shot. And I think that's what they need to do to try and loosen up this defense.
25 total yards for Minnesota, 4 possessions, 4 3 and outs. Kusick's fourth punt. Odoms lets it go, and it just bounces into the end zone. So a 60-yard punt, but only a 40-yard net, as Kusick couldn't keep it out of the end zone. Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines continues tonight on ABC. We'll see how Texas Tech responds from its huge win against Texas. They take on Oklahoma State. Others get California and USC. That's coming up tonight, 8 Eastern on ABC.
Yeah, look out for Oklahoma State today. I smell an upset in the air.
Boy, what a game that was last week down in Lubbock. Our game story here, not a lot of offense, particularly from Minnesota. They did force one turnover, or else it could be a lot worse than 6-0. Nick Sheridan back in the game. He was over on the sidelines icing up his left hand. His backup is Justin Fagan, a true freshman who had his red shirt taken off just last week. Minor with another carry. Picks up just a couple.
Take a look at this. This is where we think Sheridan maybe injured that hand. Here he is running the football. He took a pretty good pop on that play and icing it over on the sidelines. He's got a little wad of cotton in the nose. he looks like he's gone a few rounds already.
Physical Big Ten football. Sheridan hanging in there, starting for Stephen Three, out because of a concussion he suffered last week. Second and 8. Sheridan, good protection, going down the sideline for Stoneham, and it's incomplete. Trey Simmons, the best cover corner for Minnesota, was with him step for step.
And Simmons is beat. The receiver, Stoneham, has a couple of yards on him. Here it is right at the bottom of the screen. Stoneham beats the press, but the raw speed of Trey Simmons is what makes him able to close that gap and knock it away and at least interfere with Stoneham's ability to catch the ball, but that should have been caught by Stoneham.
That was a nice throw put in there by Sheridan. Now 3rd and 8. Sheridan again with time and can't quite get it. Martavius Odoms stretches, but Michigan has to punt.
Boy, and that's 2 opportunities for the Wolverines, throwing the ball down the field where the receivers did not help out Nick Sheridan whatsoever. A drop by Stoneham, and then that one by Odoms, which that ball bounced right off his face mask.
Mesko, the best punter in the Big Ten, 7th in the NCAA by average. That one a little wobbly and short.
Yeah, he missed that one totally.
So usually the best there is in his conference. Instead, shanked that one for 28 yards. And Minnesota in very good field position at midfield. So maybe we'll finally get the Gophers to get the ball into Michigan territory. But with the ball on the 50, only down by 6. The Golden Gophers about to get their 5th possession of the game. They have the ball smack on midfield, and maybe, Ray, they'll finally get into Michigan territory. It'd be tough not to do it on this drive.
Yeah, well, they need to do something. I think that they've got to throw the ball deep and loosen up this Michigan defense a little bit.
Eric Decker has only been thrown to once, by far the leading receiver on Minnesota. Weber to Decker, finally gets one, and he goes backwards. Loses about 4 yards on a big hit by Morgan Trent. Let's go to Reese Davis.
All right, Pam, Ohio State and Northwestern, they were tied at 7. Taco Bell studio update. Beanie Wells should have been stopped for nothing. Instead, Beanie's going to go for 55. Ohio State taking a 14-7 lead. They recovered a fumble, turned it into a field goal. They're up by 10 on ESPN2.
Thank you, Reese. Beanie Wells, so difficult to stop. We had a great hit by Morgan Trent for a 3-yard loss on Decker, who is now out of the game. Weber has to improvise, and he can hurt you with his feet. And finally, Minnesota is into Michigain territory with a 6-yard gain. Tim Jamison with the stop.
And you see the domination from Michigan in terms of field position, but they had one red zone fumble, and then they were forced to kick field goals a couple of times, and so they only have a 6-point lead. Now, if Minnesota can get this drive going, get a touchdown, all that plays in the opponent's territory are going to be for naught.
Martavius Odoms looking on from the sideline. This is the first play Minnesota has run in Michigan territory today. They have yet to convert a third down. Pressure coming, and down goes Weber. A terrific play right up the middle. Obiaze leading the charge.
Tim Jamison also came off the edge, and this is just Michigan dialing up a blitz at the right time. Scott Schaefer, the defensive coordinator, says it's third and medium. We're coming after you. And they got there, and Adam Weber had no chance to do anything. That pressure came so quick, he barely got into his drop, and they were upon him.
Jamison, the career active sacks leader for Michigan. Another punt for Cusick. Odoms hanging on to it around the 20-yard line. So Minnesota runs that one play in Michigan territory, then the sack throws them right back into their own side of the field. Michigan still up 6-0.
ESPN's College Football, brought to you by Planners, Instinctively Good, and Aflac. Ask about it at work.
That's a look at the new open-air facility that will open next year for Minnesota. Justin Fagan is now in as quarterback for Michigan, but look at that's going to be the biggest locker room in the country. And when they play Air Force next September 12th, the players will be coming out of that tunnel. That's right on campus. Look forward to doing some games in that building. But right now, Michigan fans looking forward to see what Justin Fagan can do at quarterback. He was a terrific option quarterback in high school in Florida.
Yeah, expect him to run the football.
And a gain up to the 25-yard line. That's a 4-yard gain for Fagan. Eric Small makes the stop, and now Sheridan comes in to relieve Fagan. Now, we expected to see a little bit of Justin today.
Yeah, he practiced throughout the week. He had been moving between that slot receiver position and quarterback throughout the season. And with the question about Stephen Threet's ability to play today, he had to go to quarterback by necessity.
Sheridan back in on 2nd and 6. Nowhere to go. Throws it downfield towards McGuffey, who did a terrific job of getting behind the defense and picked it up for a big gain. That is a 39-yard gain for the Wolverines.
And this is something that Ted Roof was worried about, McGuffey running the wheel route. Here he is. He's just going to run down outside and up along the sideline. Minnesota with no safety deep, and they lost track of McGuffey in particular after Sheridan scrambled and bought time. That was key to that play. And they're going to take a look at it. It looked like McGuffey might have been juggling that football. Tim Brewster might be challenging this thing.
Brewster calling a timeout for the Gophers. Right here, the roar in the background. That's the crowd reacting to the replay they just showed on the big screen here. McGuffey might not have had full control as he went out of bounds. John O'Neill, our referee.
Well, here's another look at it. Here's McGuffey, and you see, you can't see, but you see the foot come down out of bounds. But from that angle, you couldn't see whether or not he had maintained possession. Here, let's take a look at this one. His eyes come off the ball. He's got that football right there. That's a good catch. I think that he had both feet down.
McGuffey has been battling some injuries himself. Did not play last week. Had a concussion that he suffered against Michigan State.
Sam McGuffey is a great story. He came from poverty and a broken home, and he fought his way through. He was a great gymnast as a child. And you've seen YouTube where he can jump over people and do flip standing and all that kind of stuff. That came from his background as a gymnast.
Plays standing as a catch, as well it should. Clemens with the kick. the sideline, picking up another first down. Michigan, first down from the 16. Brock made the stop with another chunky gain of 20. Let's go back and look at some of McGuffey's magic in high school.
Well, he was just a man amongst boys. Watch the leaps and the hops he has. He kind of started jumping over people before it was the in thing to do. This is just amazing, his ability. And you know, when he first came to Michigan, there was a thing on YouTube of him jumping and doing a front flip over a teammate. And so they had him do it there, and he did it for everybody, and they were just awed by his athleticism.
Clemens with another catch for Michigan. Brock again in on the stop, but Michigan with 8 more yards. And you have to give the Wolverines a ton of credit in this game. They've been moving the ball all day on this Gopher defense. And on the other side of the ball, Michigan's much maligned defense has done a good job on Minnesota, but McGuffey, a very exciting true freshman.
And right now, the Michigan receivers are dominating the perimeter. They are blocking the defensive backs, allowing those quick screens to work.
Second and 3, Miner and Shaw in the backfield. Along with Sheridan. Miner gets it and doesn't get much. Met at the line of scrimmage. Might have lost a yard on that play.
And that was Vandesteeg. He had the penetrations, allowing Campbell to come up and make the play. But Miner wanted to cut it into that backside area. Vandesteeg, with a swing move, got up in there and forced Miner to run right headlong into traffic.
Vandesteeg played all last season with a broken wrist. His numbers were down appreciably, but he has bounced back nicely in this, his senior year.
He's got some of the best hands as far as using him to ward off blocks that I have seen.
Couple of tight ends in for Michigan on 3rd and 3. Empty backfield for Sheridan. Looking all the way to the post, and that one could have been picked off by Kyle Theret. Tony Clemens was the intended receiver.
Michigan loves to run the slant down in this area. In fact, Stoneham got his first touchdown on it last year. And watch Tremaine Brock just jump the route. And he got there before the receiver did. And Sheridan is very lucky that this one wasn't picked off.
Yeah, check that. It was indeed Brock, number 1, who almost had a goal line interception. So Michigan, again, has to settle for a field goal attempt. LaPata is 2 for 2 from 44 and 35 yards away. This one from only 26. And Michigan continues to move the ball on this Minnesota defense. 187 total yards to 21, but they only have the 9 points to show for it. Today's Aflac trivia question in snowy Minnesota. The Little Brown Jug is the second oldest rivalry trophy exchanged in all of college football. We want to know, what is the oldest rivalry in which a piece of hardware is involved? We'll have that answer coming up. The Little Brown Jug has belonged to Michigan. Sheridan continuing to ice his left hand. He's a right-handed thrower. Michigan with 9 points, 3 field goals. They do have 1 turnover in Minnesota territory and lead it by 9-0. Minnesota has done nothing on offense. Stoudemire with the kick return. A flag is down. Should negate what is a pretty good return for Stoudemire, who got it out close to the 40. Troy Wolfolk, who is Butch Wolfolk's son. Butch had a terrific career at Michigan. He made the stop.
You're right, Pam, a holding call. So Minnesota going to be stuck in some pretty poor field position to start this drive.
During the return, holding by number 32 in the return team. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
That negates a 38-yard return. Nate Triplett, a backup linebacker, whistled for the hold. So Minnesota backed up inside the 15.
Yeah, and this really cost Minnesota some field position. Take a look at this penalty. You can see it right there. Triplett just grabbing a hold and pulling down the Michigan cover man, Michael Williams.
So instead of starting at the 40, Minnesota starts at its 15. Weber connects to Jack Simmons. And the crowd goes crazy because Minnesota does indeed have its first down of the game.
And our statistician, Ed Safita, called it. Said he's feeling a first down on this drive.
They got 11 yards on that pass play. Before that, Minnesota had 7 pass passing yards on 8 attempts. Fewer than 1 yard per pass attempt, which is almost impossible to do. Gophers with the first down. On the 26.
Number 60 on the offense.
And they're going back.
Repeat first down.
Because Ryan Wynn moved prematurely.
And this has been typical of this Minnesota offense here the last 2 weeks, where they've just made some boneheaded type mistakes, some self-inflicted penalties.
Those self-inflicted wounds that offensive coordinator Mike Dunbar talks about. Eric Decker has not been a factor for Minnesota. He did sprain his ankle last week against Northwestern. Weber hanging on to it. Lunging past the 25, 5 yard gain. Let's go back to Reese Davis.
All right, Pam, Georgia's had to regroup a little bit, redefine its goals on the road against Kentucky. Jumped up 14-0, but the Cats, Tony Dixon finishes off a 15-play, 60-yard drive, and the Wildcats, who already are bowl eligible, trying to move up the bowl pecking order. Michigan State, meanwhile, has a touchdown from Javon Ringer, his 19th of the season, but having a hard time pulling away from Purdue, only a 7-point lead close to halftime.
Thank you, Reese. Weber throwing it low. Eskridge making a catch, getting it past the 32-yard line as they made the stop. 6 more yards for the Gophers, who got their first down of the game earlier on this drive. But the last 4 for them, not so good.
Those what you call 3 and outs right there. And that's bad for several reasons. You get no rhythm on offense, you get no momentum, and you also wear out your defense. Those guys are over there saying, come on, just get us one first down. I can get a little extra drink over here.
That was the last 4 drives. Minnesota had 5 straight 5 and outs. That ball tipped up in the air, and no one can come down with it. Off the hands of DeJean McKnight for the Gophers. And boy, that was flirting with disaster for Minnesota.
And a poor decision by Weber to me. I mean, he tries to jam that thing in there and throws a fastball to DeJean McKnight. And I don't know. I don't think Weber is in sync today. I haven't seen him really do anything to make a play.
Minnesota got 23 yards in that drive. They only had 21 yards on their first 5 possessions. Fair catch by Odoms at the 22-yard line after a 44-yard punt. Justin Kusick has 6 punts already in the game. All right, Duck, here we go. The Little Brown Jug is the second oldest rivalry trophy exchanged in college football, doing that since 1909. What is the oldest? And you have to go out west. The Territorial Cup, Arizona and Arizona State have been playing for that since 1899, well before Arizona was even a state, hence territorial. There was a territory back then. And no, I won't say that John McCain was there for the first game, but it was tempting. First down.
I'm glad you didn't say it.
I would never do that. First down, Sheridan flicks it out to Odoms. Odoms is met by Tremaine Brock for his 6th tackle of the day. That's a 3-yard gain. The oldest trophies, the Little Brown Jug, has been battled for since 1909. The old oaken bucket, a lot of them here in the Big Ten. And the good old golden egg between Ole Miss and Mississippi State.
The Egg Bowl.
The Egg Bowl. And Arizona State by 10 years the oldest. 2nd and 7 for Michigan, which has owned the Little Brown Jug 28 of the last 30 years. And Miner sticks it up in the middle. Hightower wrestles him down. Campbell initially got a hand on him. 3 more yards for Brandon Miner. And we talked to Tim Brewster about the Little Brown Jug, and he said that it's really not a rivalry, so we got to do something about this to get this jug back to Minnesota.
Yeah, and that's when he got the most animated in our conversation with him. That's when he talked about the physical toughness of playing 60 minutes. Said his team hasn't done that against Michigan.
Justin Fagan back in at quarterback, and he takes off. Fagan, first down and a whole lot more into Minnesota territory. Finally wrestled down at the 36-yard line by Tremaine Brock. 34 yards for the true freshman.
And he didn't get touched until he went about 34 yards, because this offensive line for the Wolverines is popping off the ball.
Fagan, recruited by most schools as a defensive back, stays in the game. And this time is taken down after a minimal gain by Lee Campbell, but he was had his red shirt taken off last week, played mostly on special teams. And Rich Rodriguez said earlier in the week he thought Fagan would play a lot more on special teams and as a slot receiver, but the concussion to Stephen Treat changed everything.
Yeah, and Michigan right now is in search of a quarterback. They've got a couple of recruits that have verbal commits to come in, and you know, that I don't know that they have found their guy just yet.
Sheridan back in to play quarterback on a second and nine. Fakes the option pitch, hangs on to it, and doesn't get much. Deion Hightower makes the stop, about a one-yard gain for Three.
Two of those guys Coach Rodriguez is looking at, Shavadrick Beaver and Tate Forcier, are quarterbacks in high school right now who have made verbal commitments to the University of Michigan. And you know how that can be.
Right.
You might change their minds and whatnot, but there certainly is opportunity to come in here and start as a true freshman next year for these Wolverines. And if they do, they're going to come in January, which is such a huge advantage.
Sheridan with that last carry, not Three. Three in wearing his warm-ups on the sideline. We'll not see him today. Sheridan throwing on the run and has his man for the first down. Martavius Odoms with a big 11-yard catch to keep the drive going.
And they may have found their guy here in Nick Sheridan. At least today, he is playing extremely well. Very accurate with the ball, even throwing on the run against the grain. Found the open receiver Odoms in a little hole in the zone, stuck it on him. I've been impressed with Nick Sheridan today.
Sheridan 5 for 17 so far in this game. Now another completion to Odoms. He'll lose yardage. A flag coming in at the end of the play. Theret made the stop. A face mask coming up. That was a 3-yard loss on the play.
And Minnesota has caught on.
Personal foul. Face mask. Number 27 on the defense. Half the distance to the goal. Automatic first down.
Even though Theret gets the penalty, he has caught on as far as the quick screen game out to the outside. They are committing that safety now to come down. There's the face mask. You can see pretty obvious by Theret. But now what Michigan has Minnesota set up for is that fake quick screen and then bam, throw it over top their head. I'm sure they've watched this thing now and they see Minnesota committing the safety quickly to that. And that's the next step in the progression of that offense.
The penalty puts the ball down on the 12-yard line. First down. Sheridan in there. Andros, the fullback, along with Miner, the tailback. Miner gets it. And then runs smack dab into a Minnesota defender. That is number 21, Simone Lawrence. A junior college transfer who's come over to Minneapolis.
Derek Onwuachi is the guy who made the initial hit in the backfield. And then Simone Lawrence finished things off.
Fourth trip for Michigan into the red zone today. They have two field goals and a turnover. Fagan back in at quarterback. Goes over the left side down to the 9-yard line. Van de Stieg, Willie Van de Stieg with a stop, but four more yards for Fagan. He's a terrific high school quarterback in Florida, and his senior year ran for over 1,300 yards and threw for over 1,400, so that's 2,700 yards right there in offense.
Minnesota player down on the field, Deion Hightower, senior linebacker, a little slow getting up. Hate to see him working on the legs there.
Third year as a starter out of Arlington, Texas. The most experienced defensive starter for Minnesota so far this season. They check on him. We have a 3rd and 6 when we come back. Deion Hightower was able to walk off the field under his own power. Nate Triplett, however, has replaced him on the field for Minnesota as Michigan. Facing a 3rd down, they're up 9-0. Nick Sheridan back in at quarterback. Brandon Miner next to him in the backfield. Miner blocks, throw in the end zone, touchdown. Greg Matthews with the catch and the score. The Wolverines finally get a touchdown after all these visits into the red zone.
Boy, and that one was a gift. The corner, Trey Simmons, played in no man's land, a few yards off the receiver. In this area, you have to press the receiver and get up and force him to make an outside release. They just gave Odoms an easy inside release, making it an easy throw. Excuse me, Matthews an easy inside release, making an easy throw for Sheridan.
Second touchdown catch of the season for Matthews. Wapata adds the extra point. Michigan up 16-0.
Yeah, and here it is right here. There's your receiver, Matthews. And look at how the defender opens the gate, turns his shoulders outside, just gives him the slant route right there. I don't understand what they were thinking about there with this offense as Simmons just gives it to him. And, you know, Michigan, they've shown this. They've shown the slant already in this area of the field today, and they've shown it on tape. You'd think that that would be what Simmons would be defending against first and foremost, and he just opened up the gate.
Very easy touchdown for Matthews. Second touchdown thrown by Nick Sheridan this season against five interceptions. And Michigan has reason to smile right now. They are leading Minnesota 16-0, just totally dominating them. 253 yards of offense to only 44 for the Golden Gophers.
Yeah.
And this is a team that's lost five straight ball games.
Yeah, and I'm going to bet you, I tell you what, I would love to be a fly on the wall in the Minnesota locker room at halftime because Brewster's going to blow his top.
Yeah, we might be able to hear him from up here.
Yeah.
Stoudemire lets it go into the end zone for the touchback. Minnesota starts at its 20 with two timeouts left. Let's go back to Reese Davis.
All right, Pam, just a few minutes away from the Best Buy halftime report. Mark and Lou enjoying the action here. And what we're keeping a close eye on, Texas. A little bit of a hangover. Baylor fell behind early, but now the Bears have tied that up at 14. Huge game in the ACC Coastal between Georgia Tech and North Carolina. Tar Heels hanging on to a 7-0 lead right now. We'll also look ahead to Texas Tech, Oklahoma State, talk Alabama, LSU. It's all coming your way on the Best Buy Halftime Report.
All right, Reese, we will see you very shortly, but let's see if Minnesota can get something done on offense. That pass is completed to Shady Solomon, another true freshman who gets playing time for the Gophers, picked up 9. Donovan Warren coming in to make the stop. Minnesota hurrying things up a little bit. The ball is loose. Weber just able to get back on top of it. Wow. They lose 5 on that play, but it could have been a whole lot worse for the Gophers.
Another self-inflicted wound there, but I'll tell you, Scott Schaefer, the defensive coordinator for Michigan, has come under a lot of scrutiny. In fact, Rich Rodriguez in his press conference got really upset because some reporters tried to point a finger at him. And Rich Rodriguez said, I'm not having any of that. And I'll tell you what, Coach Schaefer's crew has really responded here today. This is the best the Michigan defense has played all season long.
Schaefer coming over where he was Stanford's defensive coordinator last year. Weber throwing it up. Dangerous pass. That was well defended by Stevie Brown. He was looking for David Pittman. And some boos raining down from the rafters at the Metrodome.
Yeah, I think they wanted a penalty on Stevie Brown as he went up high over the back of the receiver. Watch it here at the end. Here comes Brown. And I believe the fans were probably right on that one. I think he hit Pittman before the ball got there.
7 possessions now for Minnesota. 6, 3, and outs. They have 1 first down in the entire game. Cusick getting a workout. Matthews lets it go. Takes a Michigan bounce out at the 47-yard line. So Michigan with 1 timeout and 35 seconds left to go. An opportunity perhaps to add to this 16-0 lead. That was only a 29-yard punt. Just 2 races left. Can you believe it? Jimmy Johnson tries to get his 3rd straight Sprint Cup championship. The chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues at Phoenix tomorrow on ABC. NASCAR Countdown kicks it off at 3 Eastern time. Rich Rodriguez must be pleased with what he has seen from his team after the heartbreaking loss last week at Purdue. 5 straight losses, they're up 16-0. You think he stays aggressive here?
Yeah, I think you're in great field position. Things have been working well. I would take some shots. I would definitely keep the pedal to the metal.
Sheridan in at quarterback. Garrett Brown able to stop Brandon Meyer for no gain on the play. That was a little conservative.
But the Wolverines did use the timeout here So that does mean that they're in the mindset to go after it. And a lot of times you pop a run in a situation like that and defense is playing pass, something happens for you. But look at this, the story of our game so far today. Total domination by the Michigan Wolverines. Look at this, 253 yards of offense compared to a meager 48 for the Golden Gophers.
And Michigan's defense has been porous. They are last in the Big Ten, giving up 31 points per game. 90th in the nation as far as giving up 394 yards per game. And they have been stellar so far. And that's the guy running them, Scott Schaefer, the first-year defensive coordinator, who has been, as Ray mentioned, under a lot of fire in Michigan. I think Coach Rodriguez didn't have a lot of that criticism that he's getting up there and with those folks in the greater Detroit area. Second and 10, Sheridan takes the shot towards Odoms, but it falls incomplete. Stopping the clock with 25 seconds left and a third and 10 upcoming.
And last week against Purdue, Michigan went to a three-man front. And that was a change for them. They thought it would help them getting extra guys on the edge, plates they call the overhang position against that spread offense of Purdue. And they gave up 48 points and over 500 yards. So they went back to the four-man front this week, and it's worked extremely well for them.
Facing a third and 10. Sheridan gives it to Miner, and Miner goes forward to the 50. Kyle Therrett on the stop. Clock keeps running, and Michigan is out of timeouts.
Yeah, Minnesota called a timeout, and I believe they should have. Take an opportunity to try to capture something here and go ahead and try and block a punt. Make something happen. You know, some people say, hey, just get into the locker room here at halftime and lick your wounds and get rallied back up. But that's not playing 60 minutes, and that's something that Tim Brewster preaches. And it's nice to see him back up what he talks about. He's gonna play this thing out.
Mesko has had one punt blocked this season. Michigan has dominated here in the land of 10,000 lakes. They have never lost at the Metrodome, 11-0. They've won 13 straight overall, going back to the old Memorial Stadium on campus, and have won 26 of the last 28 here in Minneapolis. Last loss here, 1967. Mesko in to punt for the Wolverines. Sherrills waits at his 10. Sky high punt. Fair caught around the 17-yard line with 5 seconds left to go for the Golden Gophers.
And Minnesota did not go after that punt, and I find that a little curious.
Yeah, why the timeout?
Exactly. Right. Why take your time out if you're not going to go try to make something happen?
So Minnesota, an anemic first half, to say the least, on offense. 7 possessions for Minnesota, 6 three and outs. They only picked up 48 yards and 1 first down. They were in Michigan territory for 1 play and then were sacked on that play to be thrown back onto their side of the field. So a lot of credit to Michigan in the first half.
And I'll tell you what Minnesota has to do at halftime. They got to get into the grill of their offensive line, and they have to start blocking people. They haven't blocked anybody this whole first half. It's not about figuring out some trick to use to all of a sudden get some space. Go block somebody.
Minnesota, they have 7 wins and are going to a bowl. Michigan with only 2 wins, but they are in control, 16-0, as we head to the studio in our Best Buy halftime report with Reese Davis.
Pam, this is familiar territory for Michigan. 26 of the last 28 in the Little Brown Jug, but they've also led, been tied at the half the last 3 games, and they lost them all. Coming up on the Best Buy Halftime Report, Ohio State got a challenge for a while. We'll show you how they turned the game against Northwestern, at least for now.
To ESPN's College Football presented by Cars.com. The second half in Minneapolis about to get underway. The gold out has not worked out so well for Minnesota. They are trailing Michigan, a team that's lost 5 in a row, 16-0, as we get ready for the second half. Minnesota had one first down in the first half. Pam Ward along with Ray Bentley. And Ray, this is not what we expected.
Not at all. In fact, a gold out. They forgot to bring their offense out is what the problem is. And Michigan has played well on offense. They put Justin Fagan in here. He rips off 34 yards on the quarterback run. And then I'll tell you what, Nick Sheridan is making a case. Nice throw here to Odoms. He has done a good job of running this offense and then producing on making throws when he has to. The touchdown there to Matthews. Nick Sheridan, pretty dang good for the first half.
Sheridan making the start in place of Stephen Treat, who is not even dressed today in his uniform because of a concussion suffered last week. Michigan with the 16-0 lead gets the ball first. Sissoko brings it out of his end zone and streaks past the 35-yard line. That is a terrific 36-yard return for Bubakar Sissoko. First half stats, Michigan dominating.
Well, look at this. I mean, the total yards, 257 to 46. That's embarrassing to come up with 46 yards and a half of football. And the Minnesota offense, the problem's there. They haven't had much imagination. They haven't taken shots deep, but they haven't blocked anybody, and that's the biggest thing.
Minnesota with 46 yards of offense and 41 yards of penalties. Sheridan completes it. Odoms slips a tackle, gets the first down, and is ridden out of bounds around midfield. That's a 15-yard gain. Hightower credited with the stop. So Michigan with a 16-0 lead in this game, but Rich Rodriguez's team has had some trouble closing out ball games this year.
Well, you look at that, four times they were either in the lead or were tied at halftime and ended up getting beat pretty handily in three of those four. So they got to finish.
Michigan 2-7 on the year. They've lost five in a row. Sheridan with plenty of time has that collapse, and then a good job coming back to the football. True freshman Darryl Stoneham gets the first down along the sideline.
Excellent move by Stoneham. He was on a go route, saw his quarterback was scrambling and in trouble, and then came back to the football. You see there Sheridan throwing the ball well on the run, sees his receiver trying to help him out, and delivers a strike along the sideline.
Stoneham had a career-high 61 yards receiving last week, and here picked up 15 yards and the first down. Miner gets hit right at the line of scrimmage. Eric Small among those getting in on the tackle, about a 1 yard gain. Justin Fagan back in playing quarterback for Michigan. He and Sheridan have been swapping off since the second quarter. Fagan the run threat. Fakes the reverse, hangs on to it, and then is taken down. Good job by Tremaine Brock to stay in his lane. He's dropped for no gain.
And the Minnesota defense hasn't played that poorly. I mean, they were on the field for a long time in that first half as Michigan had almost 20 minutes of time of possession, which was a little 11 plus for Minnesota. And so when you get on the field for that much time, it's going to wear you out eventually. But they've hung in there and they've made some stops in the red zone to keep this thing within reason and within reach.
They could use one now on 3rd and 9. Sheridan back in there, completes it. And a very good tackle by Marcus Sherrills. One-on-one tackle on Matthews. Had Matthews slipped that tackle, it would have been a first down.
I can't tell you how good that tackle it was. It's hard, especially Odoms. He's so shifty and makes a lot of moves out there. This is a big play. Look at the stick and break on the ball, and then he comes up. The only thing I would critique was that he stopped his feet, but he did wrap up very well, and then he kind of did the old alligator moves, crocodile, where you roll him up with the rest of your body.
Casey Lapata in for a 48-yard field goal. His career long is 50. And he had plenty of leg on that one. Lapata now 4 for 4 today in field goals. Michigan on its first drive of the second half extends its lead to 19-0. Today's game is being broadcast on ESPN in high definition HD, and it's never too cold for tailgating in Minnesota. What do you think of that? Some brats, some good things going on. This is not good at all. Eric Decker will not play for the rest of this game. Minnesota's leading receiver, third in the nation in catches per game, eighth in the nation in receiving yards per game. They put a boot on that left ankle that he hurt last week against Northwestern. He is done. He only caught one pass for negative 3 yards in the first half. Stoudemire with the kickoff return. It was a good job to run away from some would-be tacklers down to the 35-yard line. That's a 30-yard return. Sissoko with the stop. Let's go back to last week against Northwestern. It's the left ankle.
Yeah, you see him get rolled up, bam, right there. The defender on top of that left ankle. That's Brendan Smith from Northwestern doing the damage. And then today, the one catch that he did have, he got really walloped right there. And you see him, and he spent a little time rolling on the ground. And that, they only threw to him twice in the entire first half. And this is not good news for the Gopher offense.
By far their best receiver and Weber's favorite target. Keep it on the ground this time. And then on Eskridge. Gets 6 yards. Decker has really had a rough season. In addition to the sprained left ankle, he was literally knocked out cold in the game against Indiana on October the 4th. And then the next week, he hurt his shoulder against Illinois.
Well, he's had a target on his back with how much this offense revolves around him and how much they try to get him the football. Didn't happen early today, and it won't happen in the second half.
Second and three. And that ball is incomplete. The hit is premature. Morgan Trent laid a big hit on Kuznia, but the flag is down.
I think he got there early. Boy, he did get there in bad humor, though.
That was a huge lit on Kuznia, who has become Weber's second favorite target behind
There's
Decker.
No foul on the play. Contact took place behind the line of scrimmage, which makes the contact legal.
Yeah, you can hit a receiver before the ball comes as long as you're behind the line of scrimmage. And you see this blue line right here, that's clearly behind the line of scrimmage. So there is no pass interference on a pass behind the LOS.
Good job by the officiating crew led by John O'Neill to get together and make the correct call, even though Tim Brewster disagrees. Weber has a man, finds him. Good catch going up in the air. Brandon Green, the true freshman from Chicago, brings it in for a Minnesota first down, the 19-yard play, their longest of the afternoon. And only their second first down. You are watching Minnesota losing to Michigan 19-0. Michigan trying to snap a 5-game losing streak. They have owned this Little Brown Jug series against the Gophers, who have been struggling mightily on offense. Their best receiver, Eric Decker, out as he aggravated a left ankle injury. Weber goes down. The ball is still in Weber's possession, but he is sacked for a 3-yard loss. Give Brandon Graham credit. His ninth sack of the season, and Minnesota's first half struggles, the numbers do tell the story.
Well, you look at it, penalty yards and total yards. I mean, you do the math there. They've only really have 5-plus yards in this game. One first down. Michigan's punter has one first down. Well, two now, actually. They got one here in this third quarter.
Yep, they doubled their output. Weber hanging on to the football. Some tough yardage down to the 36. Picked up 7. Tim Jamison makes the stop on the quarterback. Even more of a load now on the shoulders of Weber with Decker out of the game.
And that's something I think they're going to need to go to is Adam Weber carrying the football a little bit more. But had a lot of success last week with that. It's tough for a defense to account for that. And they're not getting it done really in any other way right now.
He's their second leading rusher behind Aileon Eskridge this season. Did lead him in rushing last year as a freshman. Third and 6. Handoff, first down, and a whole lot more for Eskridge. Keeps his feet going all the way down to the 10-yard line. A huge third down play for Minnesota. They got 26 on the ground.
Great call by Mike Dunbar. Michigan in a two-man shell. They have man-to-man coverage on the outside and then a two-deep safety look. And they catch him on the draw. A little misdirection with it as well. Great blocking up front. Ryan Orton with the downfield block right there, springing in for some extra yards.
Eskridge taking a break. Solomon into the backfield. On first and goal, picks up 4 yards, close to the six. Brandon Graham makes the stop. Tim Brewster finally sees his team move the football.
And already you can see the production from coming out at halftime, making some adjustments. They started to throw the ball into the seam against that cover two. They got him with a little draw play. We hadn't seen that yet. So Mike Dunbar with them adjustments at halftime is moving the football.
Second and goal, Eskridge back in at the running back position. Weber hanging on to it. And taken down at the 5. Graham again in on the tackle. Another yard for Weber. So third and goal from the 5. Decker just spectating for Minnesota. What a terrific receiver he has turned into, accounting for 37% of Minnesota's receptions this season.
Yeah, and it's tough because he's the guy they like in this area, getting matched up as a single receiver on the backside and then go to him. And right now they have Broderick Smith in that position.
On third and goal. Weber can't get away, dropped for the third time today. Brandon Harrison came from his blind side for the sack.
And they were trying to go to Broderick Smith in that position where Decker normally is, but it was outstanding coverage by Michigan. A little man-to-man action right here. Donovan Warren, he takes the hand and just wraps up the receiver. Smith got away with a little bit there. That could have been easily called defensive holding.
Had a good hold of him, but was not called. Joel Monroe in to attempt a 28-yard field goal for the Gophers.
Smart decision to take the points.
Monroe, who missed a huge 20-yarder last week in a game they eventually lost to Northwestern, comes back with a 28-yard score. Minnesota finally on the scoreboard, trailing Michigan 19-3. They had a good drive, but the sack made them settle for 3.
ESPN's College Football, brought to you by Nissan, passionate about performance and proud sponsor of the Heisman Trophy, and Sonic. It's not just good, it's Sonic good.
Let's look at Al's Breakfast, very famous place in Dinkytown, which is the area around the University of Minnesota. 10 feet wide, there's 14 stools, and people hover behind them to get a seat. And we are told that it is well worth it.
Looks like it.
Yeah, that would settle pretty well right about now. Minnesota trailing Michigan 19-3. Joel Monroe, who just kicked a 28-yard field goal, kicking off. Sam McGuffey, Bubakar Sissoko are deep, waiting on the goal line for Michigan. Sissoko has it go right through his hands, recovers, and is taken down inside the 10. The ball is loose. Monroe, the kicker, was in on the hit. And he is getting greeted heartily on the sidelines as the officials say Michigan has the football.
A great job by Will Henninger, a defensive end, coming up with the fumble recovery. Sissoko doesn't handle it well, and then he's carrying it out there like a loaf of bread. Gets whacked. I don't know if that fumble was even a fumble. But nonetheless, it doesn't matter because Michigan came up with it. But Minnesota pinned him in some good field position, and that special teams can give you some life. It got this crowd into it a little bit.
Right after the field goal, Michigan with the football at the 9. Sheridan in at quarterback. Miner gets it, gets away, and then is taken down still behind the line of scrimmage. Tremaine Brock dropped him for his 9th tackle of the day. And
Miner,
now Miner's hurt.
Very slow to get up.
He has been playing with a hurt right wrist, and it looks like that is what he is favoring as he goes off the field. He's got the little brace on the wrist. Michael Shaw in form now.
Well, he ran into a brick wall right there. It was amazing to me. He had the strength to get out of it. But then he got slammed to the ground. Another big play by Tremaine Brock. Been all over the field today.
Second and 10. Sheridan gets it out to Shaw out of the backfield as we get another update here from Reese Davis.
Pam, the ability to escape. Cannot coach it, you can recruit it. Jim Tressel did with Terrell Pryor. Ohio State, Northwestern had Pryor wrapped up twice. Three guys touched him, none brought him down. Rory Nickel, touchdown, Buckeyes. 31-10 as they head to the fourth quarter on ESPN2. And things not going well for the Zookers. Western Michigan opening up a can on them, 20-7.
The big can.
How about that? They're representing the MAC quite well. Third and five. Sheridan on the move. Wide open. Greg Matthews, and he found him. Sheridan doing a good job of rolling out. Now Matthews gets into a little bit of a sideline tussle with Trey Simmons, but it's a first down Michigan.
Boy, what a great read by Nick Sheridan. And he's thrown the ball extremely well, rolling to his right today. See that little pump fake? That dropped the safety to the deeper defender, and it opened up the underneath player, Greg Matthews, and then a strike thrown by Sheridan.
Matthews now five catches for 56 yards and a score. Shaw. Simone Lawrence came up and whopped him.
Lawrence knocked himself down on that one. That was a huge hit. His right shoulder is feeling the full brunt of that one. That's what you call a stinger right there. Been there and done that. Not a very pleasant feeling.
Lawrence, in his first year at Minnesota, played his junior college ball at Valley Forge Military Academy.
Listen to this. That's a fine, how do you do? Ooh, I like it.
Lawrence did take the worst of that hit. He has five tackles and two for a loss. Minor getting looked at on the other sideline. This is 1-on-1. ABC kicks off its coverage of college football with regional action later today. Most of you will see unbeaten and number 3 Penn State take on Iowa. Others get Oklahoma, Texas A&M, or Florida State, Clemson. College football on ABC later today at 3:30 Eastern. Check your local listings for the game in your area. And Brandon Miner going back into the locker room for Michigan. His team facing a 2nd and 11. Movement up front.
False start. Number 60 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat 2nd down.
That was caused by the Gopher defense up there giving a little sugar. That's what you call a fake blitz. You give them a little sugar and then you take it away. Cause that false start by David Mooseman.
Michigan pushed back 5 more yards. Now 2nd and 16 for the Wolverines, trying to snap a 5-game losing streak with their backup quarterback, Nick Sheridan, in charge. He has shared time with Justin Fagan. Complete again, and then a good broken tackle by Matthews. Matthews, who has become Sheridan's favorite target today, picks up the first down.
And Nick Sheridan now has hit 12 out of his last 14. He's throwing strikes, and this gives your receiver a chance to go ahead and run after the catch. They caught the cornerback, Sherrills, way back, gave a 10-yard cushion, so they audible to that quick little hitch. And then after that, it was all Matthews breaking tackles and making people miss.
Matthews now 6 catches for 79 yards. He has scored the only touchdown of the game as well. First down from just over the 40. Michael Shaw now breaking free in a foot race. Shaw finally is chased down by Trey Simmons, but another big chunk of yardage for Michigan. That's a 48-yard run.
And it's all about the line up front. The right side, Mooseman and Steven Schilling, and Ferrara's in there, rotating at times, but Mooseman taking this series. And this is it. Watch this, just over to the right side. A great job of passing off. I'll tell you what, the center, David Moak, was outstanding on that play. He cut off the nose and then got to the second level to the linebacker. And bam, that's all Shaw needed. He was up onto that third level, the defensive backs, before anybody could really react.
Much more than triple the yardage now for Michigan over Minnesota. Fagan in at quarterback. First down at the 12. Fagan fakes the throw and hangs on to it, getting inside the 10 to around the 8-yard line. Picked up 3 on that play. So Michael Shaw in for Brandon Miner, who is out with the injury. Shaw already averaging almost 6 yards per carry coming into this game. Got 48 on that run.
And he's another one of those true freshmen that has great promise and a future here, and a very explosive player.
Fagan on 2nd and 7. Good cutback and is taken down around the 5-yard line. Derek Onwuachi making the stop, the junior from California. And here comes Sheridan back into play quarterback.
And I like how Michigan, Calvin McGee, the offensive coordinator, is using his personnel today. Really keeping the Minnesota defense on their heels as far as, all right, who's in the game and then what do they do out of this? It's keeping them with some imbalance in what they're expecting. They've got them off balance right now.
On a 3rd and 5, have to get to the 2 to keep the drive going. Shaw kept in the block, and that pass is thrown short of Martavius Odoms.
It's one of the few times where Nick Sheridan did not throw a strike while on the run, but that thing came open, and his feet weren't how he usually likes them, and he had to get rid of the ball on time, and because the feet weren't set up and he couldn't wait because they're running out of real estate with that route going to the sideline, he threw a dirt ball.
And because of the dirt ball, they have to go for a field goal. KC Lapata has already hit 4 of them. He had 0 field goals in his last 2 games coming into this one. This one from 23. His last one was good from 48.
This will make it a 3-possession ball game.
Lapata now 5 for 5 in field goals as Michigan extends its lead to 22-3. Remember, they were pinned back at the beginning of that drive, and that young man, Michael Shaw, really gave him some great real estate with a 48-yard run to help set up the field goal. Only 2 races are remaining. Jimmy Johnson looks to hold off a hard-charging Carl Edwards as Jimmy tries for a 3rd straight Sprint Cup championship. Check it out in Phoenix tomorrow. NASCAR Countdown begins your race day at 3 Eastern time. Big Ten standings. Penn State is head and shoulders above everybody else right now because they are still unbeaten. Michigan State goes to Happy Valley in the final game of their respective regular seasons. And look at Minnesota. Are they about to lose their 2nd straight game in the Big Ten? And Michigan, who a lot of people left for dead, is a team that really has nothing to play for but pride. They're not going to go to a bowl game. They're assured of their first losing season since 1967, and they've looked really good today.
They really have, Pam, have made very few mistakes and haven't hurt themselves. I mean, if you would put anything on them, it's the red zone problems. They haven't converted for the touchdowns. They've settled for field goals.
Minnesota with another stab at it. Stoudemire fields the kickoff, shows some of his speed, and is taken down around the 38-yard line. That's a 30-yard return. Boy, if Troy Wolfolk didn't get him, that might have been a touchdown.
He had a head of steam going there.
And now for our Bowl Buzz, brought to you by Garmin GPS. 3 non-BCS schools still unbeaten, including Ball State, who's looking great. Michigan out of a bowl for the first time since 1974 when they were 10-1 and couldn't go to a bowl because it was the Rose Bowl or nothing back then. And 5 teams in the Big Ten eligible for bowls, including Minnesota.
And they changed that rule in 1975, and then a Big Ten team could go to a different bowl other than the Rose Bowl.
Can you imagine 10-1 and you don't go to a bowl game? Now you go if you're a 500 team. That pass is incomplete here on the sideline looking for Ben Kuznia.
Well, that ball had eyes. It got through a bunch of hands there, but give Steve Brown the credit, the safety over the top. He hit Kuznia, and that was really what forced that incompletion. Take a look at the end of this right here. Brown's going to come through there, right there. He's right on the coverage, and Kuznia By the time he got possession, he was out of bounds. He juggled that thing, and then it popped right out of his belly.
Minnesota playing this second half without its best receiver, Eric Decker, standing on the sidelines with a boot on his left ankle that he hurt last week against Northwestern. Weber keeps it. Throws his body over the 45-yard line, picked up 8 yards. Terrence Taylor made the stop for Michigan. Taylor, one of very few returning starters on defense, and he is slow getting up.
Terrence Taylor is one of the stalwarts on this Michigan team, a senior, one of the leaders of this group, and that's, I think that's a shortage. You know, you look at Michigan's team from last year, they lost all their major leaders, and that's one of the deficiencies, in my opinion, of this ball team. They don't have that strong senior class that can get guys playing and get them whipped up into a frenzy.
Taylor, a 3-year starter out of Muskegon, Michigan.
Great program on the west side of the state.
And there's the big guy, over 300 pounds, making his way off the field for the Wolverines.
Tony Anise, his high school coach, has the Muskegon football team rolling again in the playoffs in the great state of Michigan. Played my alma mater, Hudsonville, last night. Or actually, they play him today.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's always a big
a little nervous about that.
Third and one. And they're not going to get it. Stopped dead in his tracks. DeLeon Eskridge, true freshman from San Francisco for Minnesota.
Boy, that was a heck of a play by Will Johnson.
Got to go for it here, right, Ray?
Yes,
fourth down?
Definitely. You're running out of opportunities in time in this ball game. You know, in fact, another thing I would recommend is maybe getting into a change that tempo.
Eric Decker on the sidelines with the boot on his hurt ankle. Fourth and one. Weber with the pitch to Eskridge, gets the first down into Michigan territory. Stevie Brown makes the stop. They needed a yard, they got six.
Perfect execution of the speed option. Weber comes downhill. See how he attacks the line of scrimmage? That forces the defense to commit. And then they've got blocking on the outside. They block the pitch guy. Somebody is assigned to the pitch, and he gets blocked. And the safety, Brown, has to come up and make the tackle. Very nice executed play for the Golden Gophers.
Weber, the quarterback. Mike Dunbar, the second-year offensive coordinator. Weber zips it out for about a 2-yard gain to Kuznia.
And they keep running those bubble screens, those quick screens out there, and Michigan has defended that very well throughout the day. And coming in, I can see why that was a big part of their plan, because Michigan struggles in space for the most part. But today, their corners have done a great job of getting off blocks and stopping those quick passes to the outside.
They are one of the worst teams statistically as far as giving up passing yards per game in the 100 statistically, but they're doing well today. Weber had to throw that one away. He was under tremendous pressure by Brandon Graham, who has one of 3 Wolverine sacks today.
Also, Brandon Harrison, the safety, came up late for a blitz, and he was totally unencumbered to the quarterback. And when you got a guy running free on a blitz, that's all the quarterback can do is get rid of it hot and throw it out of bounds. He had no receivers looking back to him. They didn't read that blitz, didn't adjust their routes.
Harrison also has a sack today for Michigan. There you see the Minnesota student section. Be acting very unstudent-like. Not a lot to cheer about today. Third and 7 could be the last play of the quarter. Eskridge slips a tackle, runs for the first down. A good way to end the third quarter for the Golden Gophers as they tracked him down. 16 yards for Eskridge. Tim Brewster can only hope that that play catapults his team into doing something in the fourth quarter. Michigan with a 22-3 lead. Little brown jug tucked away. That's what they're playing for.
Saturday night football on ABC. Oklahoma State, Texas Tech, or Cal USC.
So I asked my dad where he wanted to go for his 60th birthday.
Welcome back. This is our game track. Michigan has the only touchdown of the game. And a lot of defense, 3 sacks for Michigan. This Minnesota offense has really struggled. Rich Rodriguez's team has certainly answered the call They have lost five straight ball games and lost a heartbreaker last week to Purdue. They know they're not going to have a winning season for the first time since 67. They know they're not going to a bowl game, unlike the Gophers. And Michigan has been out playing Minnesota. First and 10, first play of the fourth quarter. Ball delivered low but caught by Jack Simmons, the tight end, just short of the 20-yard line. Picked up 7 yards. Minnesota trailing this game 22-3. Both teams coming off of losses last week. Casey LaPata has 5 field goals, the first kicker to have 5 field goals in a game for Michigan since 1990. Kirk Decker, the great wide receiver for Minnesota, has not played the second half because of a hurt left ankle. Weber doesn't get much. Brandon Harrison made the stop. Michigan has won the last 13 games here at Minnesota so long ago that it happened in 1977 at Memorial Stadium, not even here at the Metrodome.
Yeah, and Coach Tim Brewster was talking about a rivalry. He says, you know, it's not a rivalry unless both teams win. And he has been really adamant and preached to his guys all week long about coming out and playing hard for 60 minutes. I don't know that he's gotten that.
Weber with the toss to Eskridge, who shows a flash of speed to get it inside the 10. First and goal coming up for the Gophers on Eskridge's 13-yard run.
Had some great blocks to open this thing up. Here he's going to do the same deal we saw earlier that Michigan ran. And watch the block by Kuznia right here at the end. Right there, number 16, knocking the safety inside. And that's Stevie Brown, and that allowed him to get inside the 10-yard line. And Minnesota threatening to score here and try to make a game of this. But I still think they should be in hurry-up.
Eskridge averaging 11 and a half yards per carry in the second half. Gets it again. Spins, loses the football. Michigan says they have it.
And they do. Brandon Graham, looked like to me, ended up on that football. Excuse me, I think it was Oliaze. They're not going to give it to him, it looks like. There's still no decision out there.
Kuznia came out of the, Kuznia came out of the pile with the football for Minnesota.
Well, here's another look at it. You see that ball is definitely out and on the ground. Tim Jamison forced it, and there, right there. He's got that football. That's Obiase. But Kuznia got into the pile right there, and he took it from him. That's a heads-up play by Kuznia, seeing a football and grabbing hold of it.
Should have been Michigan's football, but instead Minnesota hangs onto it. Oh, Weber drops the low snap, covers up, loses 8 yards on the play.
Boy, you talk about a stall for your offense. You get right down in there inside the 10, and you fumble on back-to-back plays. Low snap coming from Trey Davis, who's taking his rotation in there at center in replace of Jeff Tau Arnett. And Weber's eyes didn't get back down to look for the ball quick enough, even though that snap was low.
Third and goal now from the 14-yard line.
Minnesota can't afford to try any more field goals. They need touchdowns.
Weber throws it to the 5-yard line, looking for Kuznia. Stevie Brown was able to get in front of him and get a hand on the football.
Heck of a play by Stevie Brown. Coming over the top, getting his body over the top of Kuznia and breaking it up. And now they are going for that field goal. And I don't know, I guess it gets you to within 2 scores. So now you get 2 touchdowns and 2 two-point conversions. You'd be down 16 if you make this. So I can see the wisdom of it from Tim Brewster.
Joel Monroe is hit from 28 today, this one from 32. Minnesota now trailing 22-6. But a couple of fumbles brought him back into field goal range. Tim Brewster, the head coach of Minnesota, moved the trophy case for the Little Brown Jug into the players' lounge area because he wanted his players to see it all week, and it might still be empty after this week.
Yeah, it might just be, and that will be a real thorn in Tim Brewster's side. They really felt they had an opportunity to maintain regain the possession of that prize, Little Brown Jug. The story goes all the way back to 1903. And Michigan came to Minnesota to play that game, and they didn't trust the water that would be allowed for them.
And they brought their own jug. McGuffey catapults over the 30-yard line with the kickoff, a 21-yard return for Sam. Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines continues tonight on ABC. Texas Tech, how will they respond after that huge win against Texas, takes on Oklahoma State. Others get California, USC. That's tonight, 8 Eastern on ABC. Should be a heck of a game between Oklahoma State and Tech. All of Lubbock buzzing about their football team, and rightly so. Michigan with a 22-6 lead over Minnesota. Nick Sheridan starting for Stephen Threat, gives it to McGuffey. McGuffey loses a yard. We get an update from Reese Davis. Reese.
All right, Pam. Baylor made it interesting for a while against Texas with that fabulous freshman quarterback, Robert Griffin, but the veteran Colt McCoy, well protected. Brandon Collins, 40 yards for the touchdown. Now Mack Brown's team appears to have shaken off the Bears. It's 35-14 deep in the third. North Carolina shutting out Georgia Tech 21-0 in the fourth quarter in Chapel Hill.
Thank you, Reese. Right here we have a Minnesota team trailing 2-7 Michigan. McGuffey again over the right side, dropped by Nate Triplett, who has been in for Deion Hightower playing linebacker. McGuffey picking up 3 yards.
This Michigan offense, which is a no huddle by trade, are trying to really work the clock. They're in that 4-minute offense mode with 10 minutes and a half to go in the ball game, trying to eat up as much of it as possible. They want to snap that ball with that thing under 10.
Stephen Threat on the left wearing his warm-up clothes today. Was not able to practice at all this week because of the concussion suffered last week and the loss to Purdue. 3rd and 8. Sheridan under pressure steps away and gets nailed just as he let the ball loose. Terrific pressure. Deion Hightower in there along with Derek Onwuachi.
Great pressure from the outside. Closing in. You can see it. A blitz comes. Hightower actually back in the ball game, and he's the one who ends up getting the pressure right there along with Onwuachi. And a good 3-and-out for the Minnesota defense.
Punt by Mesko is a boomer. Fair catch by Sherrills on a 49-yard punt for Mesko. So Minnesota has a lot of work to do and only about 10 minutes left to do it.
Congrats, got a...
ESPN's College Football is presented by Cars.com, where confidence comes standard, and in part by Prescription Flomax.
Some of the faces of the men who have fought for the Little Brown Jug, second oldest trophy in college football. Michigan has won 2 straight and 35 of the last 38 in this lopsided series. Justin Fagan, the true freshman quarterback, is keeping warm on the sidelines. And in that blue bin, that's where the Little Brown Jug is being
offside
held.
Number 66 on the defense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
I think it was a miscall. He meant 67, Terrence Taylor. And Brandon Miner is not going to come back into the ball game. He was shaken up earlier in the third quarter. He'd been playing with a hurt right wrist. We don't have an updated report on him, but Miner had 14 carries for 53 yards and then went out for the Wolverines. That was only Michigan's second penalty of the day. Eskridge cut so hard he lost his balance and didn't pick up anything. Tim Jamison with the stop.
And I'm surprised Minnesota is going back into a huddle. I don't understand that. Under 10 minutes left, down 16. That's time to get it going. Time to hurry it up.
Adam Weber has been working this entire second half without his roommate and favorite target, Eric Decker. And that pass is completed to Brandon Green, the true freshman, stretching out to make the catch.
This is a halftime adjustment that the Minnesota offense made. You're going to see a cover two by Michigan. And so that corner sits and then lets that guy go, carries him a little bit. But early in the game, that corner was sitting and waiting for the out route, the complimentary route, and it's too late for the safety to get over there, so you slam it in there in between them in that gap. Good execution, nice adjustment.
Big gain puts it up at the 41-yard line. Weber goes down. Sacked for the fourth time today. Tim Jamison came in high on him.
That's just a one-on-one matchup. Jamison coming around the edge. And getting it done. This is a good pass rush, a power pass rush. Here he is up top right here, and watch him just working on the offensive tackle. Bam, hits him in the chest. Beats Mankey around the edge with a power move, a bull rush, and then a speed move around him.
Loss of 6 yards on the play. Weber right on the nose to Jack Simmons, his tight end. Check that, Nick Tau Arnett, the backup tight end, for a 30-yard gain.
Tau Arnett just shows you the strength that he has. Here's a nice throw, too. You saw Weber look it off. That brought the safety out of there. And then watch the power of Tau Arnett just running through this coverage. Bam, right there, locking it up, making a nice catch in the seam.
Boy, and the Tau Arnett family, a great story for Minnesota. There are three brothers on this team. All three of them walked on, the oldest of whom, Nate, is a defensive back who has yet to play, a 26-year-old walk-on freshman.
Minnesota still just not taking advantage of the clock.
Weber on the run. Has it fall incomplete. There was a collision downfield. A flag is on the play. David Pittman was the intended receiver. He and Charles Stewart ran into each other downfield. Hold on the Gophers. Let's go back to Reese Davis.
All right, Pam, remember a couple weeks ago Kentucky couldn't get a punt off against Florida? Or maybe the Wildcats took notes. Brian Mims gets his punt blocked for Georgia, sets Kentucky up on the doorstep in a 21-17 game. And Randall Cobb picks his way through the Bulldogs to give the Wildcats the lead. But just seconds ago, Noshawn Marino scored. Dogs back on top. Wild win in Lexington, 28-24.
The good old SEC. Thank you so much, Reese. Here, we're just under 8 minutes left to go. Minnesota pushed back because of the penalty and pushed back even more. That did not work. Broderick Smith met as soon as he caught the ball and dropped for a 3-yard loss by Brandon Harrison.
The Minnesota receivers are just not blocking people. And that, we've seen that same thing happen many times right here. Watch this defender. He's going to defeat the block and then come up and make the play in the backfield. He beat the block of David Pittman, comes up, makes the hit. Brandon Harrison having a heck of a day.
Harrison with one of the four sacks for the Wolverines today. That pass is picked off, thrown right to Morgan Trent. Trent with the interception, Michigan football.
And this is the same thing I talked about earlier, where Michigan is keeping that corner in a cover two in the flat area, anticipating the out route. And Morgan Trent just sees it and takes care of it. Does an excellent job. Here he is right down here. And the receiver is going to run a route deep, and he's just going to stay there. And he's going to wait for that out to come. See him sit down and then come up and bam. He's in perfect position. Eyes on the quarterback the whole way. This time he makes the catch instead of the big hit.
Trent with his third pick of the season. His other two came against Notre Dame. Shaw, the running back, now that Brandon Miner has been shut down for the rest of the day. Stopped by Kyle Ferrett. So Trent had a big hit earlier in this game coming up with the pickoff, and Minnesota had been living on turnovers. Today they are even. They had 27 takeaways on the season. Had one earlier in this game down in the Michigan was in their red Minnesota's red zone. But boy, this game is baffling in many respects.
Yeah, the Minnesota offense did not show up here today for whatever reason.
And some of the Minnesota faithful are heading for the exits. Second down, Sheridan flares it out to Odoms. And he is taken out of bounds after a 4-yard gain. Trey Simmons on the stop for Minnesota, and there they go. Not the kind of day they expected. They had a terrific crowd last week for homecoming against Northwestern. They lost in an interception return for a touchdown with 12 seconds left to go. And this one is a stunner. Michigan coming in at 2-7 on a 5-game losing streak. There's the diamond stack again on the right side.
They're waiting for that play clock to wind on down. Smart play, good game management.
Sheridan, the son of a football coach. Holds on to it after the fake. And Nick plows his way towards a first down, gets it. Lee Campbell with the stop. And Michigan moves the sticks. So Minnesota about to go down to its second straight defeat. A couple of more games left to go. We mentioned they're playing for the Little Brown Jug today. They have a couple of more trophy games coming up. They go to Wisconsin to play for Paul Bunyan's axe and then finish up with Iowa. That's the Floyd of Rosedale game. The pick trophy.
Nice.
And boy, they're going to a bowl game, and they have the 7 wins, but yeah, not the capper they were looking for.
They might be looking at a 7-5 season. And there's still work to be done here. Tim Brewster would tell you that.
McGuffey, the tailback, on 1st and 10. He slithers through the smallest of holes and then is taken down, but not before he got a first down. Brock on the stop, 14 yards for McGuffey.
McGuffey has great power for a smaller back, 5'11", 185 pounder, bounced off Eric Small. Here he's gonna come right through the line, finds that little seam right there. He bounces off Eric Small. Small didn't wrap him up, didn't really probably see him coming because McGuffey is you know, he hides behind that big line sometimes.
And McGuffey is a little banged up. Remember, he did not play last week because he suffered a concussion against Michigan State the week before. Did not play at Purdue. So Michael Shaw, another true freshman in the backfield, gets the football. And Shaw spins down to the 22-yard line. Theret with yet another stop. So Minnesota has to gather itself to close out the season. And Michigan, this is a sort of a tumultuous week, certainly for Rich Rodriguez. After his team, with the loss last week to Purdue, they were assured of a losing season and assured of not going to a bowl. And they have been very balanced, over 200 yards rushing and 200 yards passing today. Sheridan again waiting for the play clock to wind down to about 4 seconds. And Shaw is taken down around the 20-yard line by Eric Small, excuse me.
Rich Rodriguez had a testy press conference. He threw in a couple of Jesus and goshes, and you know, he said, hey, we've only been here 10 months. And things, you know, it takes time. And he said he's been through it before. 7 years ago, his first year at West Virginia, had a 2-win season when they came out of the blocks there. And it takes some time when you change everything over from what he did, from a power pro style offense to this spread option type offense. You've got basically, you know, round holes and you got square pegs. He needs a little time to get his personnel into those pegs, and this thing will turn around.
Sheridan hanging on to it, runs for the first down. He is very excited about the guys he is bringing in next year, especially a couple of quarterbacks. Michigan's remaining schedule, as they play it out, we will have them next week in Ann Arbor hosting Northwestern. And then the old season closer against Ohio State.
That can be a season saver right there. If Michigan were to pull the unthinkable and upset the Buckeyes, Rich Rodriguez, he would be it'd be a complete 180 from how the fan base and the media are treating him in Ann Arbor.
Stephen Treat, they didn't need him today. The starting quarterback out with a concussion has watched Sheridan and Justin Fagan do a really good job at quarterback. Good changeup quarterbacks between the two. Four more yards for Michael Shaw. And Rich Rodriguez said that the things you want to do is, firstly, his formula for fixing things, identify the things that keep you from winning games, and then solve those problems. It sounds simple,
yeah,
but he said, you know, they're easy to identify them. Solving them, obviously, is not so easy. But he kept emphasizing, both with us and in his regular press conference on Monday, he thinks this team and program is on the right track.
Yeah, he thinks that the transition is coming. He sees things every week in practice where, you know, lights are coming on for people.
He says it is not translated on Saturday. Sunday through Friday, it's going well, but they have yet to really put it together in a game. This has been a very impressive performance against a team that was in the top 25 until they lost to Northwestern last week. Three more yards for Sheridan, who has come in and done a really good job. His dad, a linebackers coach for the New York Giants, used to be an assistant with Michigan, and his dad picked himself up a Super Bowl ring last year. Nick was able to go see that game. Must have been a thrill for him.
And Nick wants to be a coach himself when the playing days are done. And, you know, he said, I'd rather do that than work.
He's working for a living. Even though it is a lot of work. Third and four for the Wolverines. Wolverines have done a terrific job holding on to the football. This drive over 5 minutes and 40 seconds already, as they're chewing out this victory. Shaw close to the first down marker with the carry. ABC kicking off its coverage of college football later today with regional action. Most of you will see Penn State unbeaten taking on Iowa. Others get to see Oklahoma and Texas A&M or Clemson, Florida State. College football on ABC later today at 3:30 Eastern. That's 2:30 Central. Check your local listings for the game in your area. It is indeed a first down, first and goal from the three for Michigan. This drive now over 6 minutes, 6 minutes and 20 seconds.
A great closing drive, and the offensive line has been so effective the entire day.
Five different combinations on the O-line because of injuries. They open up the hole that time for Mark Mundros, goes in for the touchdown, and Michigan can safely say they're holding on to the little brown jug.
They'll keep it for another year, and that'll be a little feather in the cap of Rich Rodriguez. He's going to take that, some of the heat that's been on him, going to just let some of that pressure off, and they did it up front today. The offensive line outstanding throughout. No sacks allowed, 230-plus yards rushing. Great performance.
Lapata adds the extra point on a great drive by Michigan that chewed up 6 minutes and 42 seconds of clock time. 34 seconds left to go. They can put yet another score on the jug that stays with the Wolverines. All right, there are 34 seconds left in the game, but Ray, we're going to do it. We're going to officially say that Michigan has won its 14th straight Little Brown Jug right here in the city of Minneapolis, and this is it. They will no longer play in the Metrodome, so Michigan a perfect 12-0 playing Minnesota in this building. Golden Gophers going to their new on-campus facility next season. Stoudemire picks up the rolling kickoff and does his best to keep the game alive. Spun down at the near the 20 after a 3-yard gain. Ran a lot farther than 3 yards. Stevie Brown made the stop. Good job by Nick Sheridan coming in with Treat out with a concussion. They have never lost. They will leave perfect 11-0 at the Metrodome. Last loss here, 1977. And in that game, Adam Weber's dad and Jack Simmons, the tight end's dad, they played in that game, and they talked about how they looked at some of the grainy film of that, particularly Weber, but they're not going to have any such good memory winning here in Minneapolis.
Now, a huge disappointment for Tim Brewster and his staff, losing consecutive Big Ten games here, and they got some work left to do with this program, but they have done a great job of getting things on the right path. And then congratulations to Rich Rodriguez, getting that little brown jug back, and more importantly, getting Michigan a big and much needed victory.
Challenged his team, particularly his seniors, to close out the season strong. and they played very well today, limiting Minnesota to 6 first downs and 188 total yards. This from a Michigan defense that had been giving up 394 yards per game. Great effort for them. They win it 29-6 with Sheridan and Fagan sharing the quarterbacking duties. Our final score, Michigan has beaten Minnesota 29-6. So Minnesota falls to 7-3. Michigan picks up its third win of the season, and they play Northwestern next week. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Ray Bentley and our entire ESPN crew, I'm Pam Moore. We say so long from Minneapolis, where Michigan wins big 29-6. Let's go to Reese Davis in the studio.
This is College Football Scoreboard, presented by Acura.
At the bottom of the hour, many of you here on ESPN will see the Iowa Hawkeyes trying to ruin the national championship dreams of Penn State. Now, many of you, if you want to watch that game, can see it on your local ABC station. Others see it here on ESPN, College Football, presented by Cars.com. Glad to have you with us inside the studio alongside my Hall of Fame running mates, Lou Holtz, Mark May. I'm Reese Davis.
Am I in the Hall of Fame as a player or as a coach? I haven't figured that out yet.
You are in as a coach, but due to your exploits at Kent State, perhaps that's an oversight that we can address with the National Football Foundation. Not exactly a Hall of Fame season for Michigan this year. In fact, their bowl streak comes to an end. Their run of 4 decades of winning records coming to an end. But they win the Little Brown Jug. I know they win it every year. But when you've had a season like Rich Rodriguez has had in his first year, what can a win like this, a decisive one over a winning team, do for your program?
It just does wonders for you mentally. You get to say to the players, hey, we're getting better, man. Believe in the program. And you cannot underestimate the importance of this win, because this football team never gave up. They were ahead of Purdue last week, 14-0, blew it. When you have a lead and everything's going against you and all the complaint, all the negativeness, to stay in there and compete and believe in your coach and your coaching staff, that said volumes about Coach Rodriguez.
I think if you look at this program, Coach Rich Rodriguez does not have all the components to his offense that he wants. That's obvious, but at least you can see that there are growing in this program. Players are starting to believe in the system, and it's evident by today's score, the 29 points, and last week, the points that they put on the board. I think it's key now that everybody in the system is really starting to believe, to buy in. They're not a magnificent team. They're not a superpower, but the bottom line, they're getting better, and they're getting those victories so they have a great taste in their mouth in the offseason.
And ultimately, Minnesota, a couple more tough games left. This game potentially could have cost them a trip to Florida for a bowl game, at least to one of the major ones. They're still going bowling. Great turnaround for Tim Brewster, but a disappointing day for the Gophers. You know, this is the time of year you start to see teams stub their toes, especially if they've been just a little bit disappointed, like Texas. Texas had the heartbreaking loss at the end of a 4-game run that was just unbelievable in difficulty. Now an improving Baylor team comes in. But Colt McCoy, he goes right to work. Quan Cosby, who was nicked up against the Red Raiders a little bit, in there catches the touchdown pass. Now McCoy's going to get drilled as he throws, Mark. It'll be picked off by Chris Burke. As the Horns were up 14-0, Baylor gets right back in it.
Well, it's a safety blitz. He gets hit right in the chin on that, but a terrific job by Baylor blocking down the field to play, taking this return inside the 10-yard line.
Led to a Robert Griffin touchdown. Baylor down 14-7. Baylor had tied it at 14. Griffin, the freshman, had only thrown one interception all year, and hard to blame him for that one. A pick six by Ryan Palmer, Longhorns up 21-14, and McCoy would find Crosby again.
Well, the Crosby's just having an incredible breakout year. He's a fifth-year senior, hopes to be able to come back for a sixth year.
McCoy was not done. Colts having himself an afternoon. Heisman Trophy contender, some believe still the leader, looking for Brandon Collins right down the gut. Collins hauls it in. Jordan Shipley has scored in this game, too. Shipley has scored a touchdown in every game this season. 42-14 and a lot of time left in Austin.
Now it's starting to look like the Texas Baylor schools of the past.
It is, but this is not the same Baylor team. This is Robert, Robert Griffin, over 100 yards rushing. He has thrown the interception, and not great percentage-wise in completion percentage, but he is a guy who can build a program around for Art Briles. 42-14. The score there. Ohio State still hoping to get a share of the Big Ten against Northwestern. Ohio State 15-2 under Tressel following the loss. And of course, they lost to Penn State. Beanie was all wrapped up by men in purple, but nobody tackled it.
That's why he's 15-2 after a loss. You got guys like Beanie Wells. Didn't get real good block at his point of attack, but nice effort finding the open area.
Mark, would it be unfair to say that tackling was optional for the Northwestern defense today? Look, they should have had Terrell Pryor here.
They should have. But when you're big time on a big stage like this, making a play like this, what a phenomenal job by the freshman Terrell Pryor.
Rory Nickel hauling it in. Ohio State pulling away and scoring one in the final seconds just for a little exclamation point. 45-10. Pryor only threw 14 times but completed 9, 3 of them for scores, nearly 200 yards. And the Buckeyes roll on. They go to Illinois next. And Illinois right now is trailing Western Michigan with about 3.5 to go at home. The wheels coming off the wagon for the Zucker at the moment. We'll keep an eye on that one for you. Okay, so Purdue and Michigan State, very quietly, Javon Ringer and the Spartans in position to play for a share of the Big Ten title. Ringer, second leading rusher in the nation. 18 touchdowns coming in, rips off 21, and then we get his 19th TD.
Just powering it. Javon Ringer's been incredible this year running the football. He's carried Michigan State the entire season.
What about the defensive play here by Johnny Adams?
Oh, this is just a nice play. Being able to sit back, read the quarterback's eyes, and break on the football.
It was Justin Siller who threw the interception, led Purdue against Michigan last week and very successful against a home state team. He's a kid from Detroit, a young quarterback. Not so much in East Lansing. Sparty about to go to 9-2, 6-1 in the league.
How about that pitch in the shutout? Mark D'Antonio's team, that's outstanding. He's a defensive-minded coach. Run the ball, stop the run, shut him down. That's what they've done in this game.
Okay, I don't know if you're fully aware of how the Big Ten potentially could shake out. Now, this is what we're talking about for the automatic bid to the BCS. Penn State, obviously, if they went out, they're going. If they lose only to Iowa or Indiana, they would be in good shape as well because they have beaten Ohio State and in that scenario would have beaten Michigan State. But what if Michigan State beats Penn State and there's a three-way tie? Guess who gets the automatic bid to the Rose Bowl?
Who?
Michigan State.
Wow.
Because the tiebreaker that would apply in that case would be fewest 1AA or football championship subdivision opponents. Michigan State didn't play any. So the Spartans, in theory, unless Penn State's upset before then, would be going into Happy Valley potentially to play for a trip to the Rose Bowl.
And that would be a huge feather in Mark D'Antonio's cap and his football team. And Javon Ringer, the way that he's carried his football team this year. You know about the huge yards he's had, but scoring touchdowns, when they get inside the 5-yard line, he finds a way to get it in the end zone. And Brian Hoyer has really stepped up as a quarterback for Michigan State this year.
Oh, they just played very well, and they play intelligently. You know, they just hang in there, find a way to win. Against Wisconsin last week, they were outgained. It looks like they're going to beat. They find a way to win. Congratulations to Coach Dan Antonio.
I can picture this game. It's going to be cold and windy, and the snow is going to be blowing. It's going to be like old-time football. It's going to be a great game to play. It's going to be one of those games, physical defense by Penn State. Michigan State's going to try to establish the run. That's what they do best, so it's going to be a great game to watch.
Michigan State has an open date. They get a week to prepare for it, but you could take 3 weeks and prepare for Penn State, and that may not be enough.
Land-Grant Trophy.
Another one.
Drag the record books to the recycle bin when you're playing for the Land-Grant Trophy, as Michigan State and Penn State will. Obviously, the Nittany Lions, not even thinking about that. Bottom of the hour, they've got a date with Iowa that will consume their attention for the moment. Think that's confusing, the Big Ten, how it might shake out? Nothing compared to the ACC, particularly the Coastal Division, Georgia Tech, North Carolina. Sean Drawn is going to rip off 36.
Oh, just a nice run. Boy, he just has good peripheral vision. That's probably the most important thing a back needs. Be able to see the field, know where to cut in, when to cut out.
Georgia Tech going for it on a 4th-and-3 to give to Jonathan Dwyer. Not close on the option.
No, they're not reading the option particularly well. Here you see it again, a little bit indecision.
Both times on 4th down. Both times, Butch Davis's defense stopped them. And in a 14-0 game, Ryan Houston punches it.
And a nice job just running it right up the middle behind the center. Great blocking by the offensive line, a sealing each side. Easy touchdown for North Carolina.
And North Carolina, that is now final. 28-7, severely hampering the opportunity for Georgia Tech to make it to the ACC championship game. A lot of different permutations and combinations, but Carolina's still in it. Virginia Tech controls its destiny in that ACC Coastal. We started the day with five teams with two losses. Now, obviously, to update that, Georgia Tech would be 4-3 and falling behind the two-loss teams, the rest of them at 3-2, and North Carolina joins that group with its victory over Georgia Tech. And now in the Atlantic, you see that's also a mess up. Florida State and Maryland, they're going to play in a couple of weeks. Oh, Wake Forest sort of quietly in it.
If you could pick one team, you can't really zero in on one team, but out of each division, I like Florida State because I think Florida State right now, Christian Ponder, they're starting to really feel their groove and score points offensively, and their defense is always strong under defensive coordinator Mickey Andrews. But on the other side, I really think I like Virginia Tech. The way that they played the other night, they finally got their running game going. Both quarterbacks have been nicked up, but they found a way to win, and the defense is coming along. And the teams that can run the ball and get it done in November, I really think in this conference, will find a way to get the job done and win it.
But I think the team is playing better than anybody out right now is North Carolina. I mean, they're really coming along under Coach. He just really has them, just like he did down in Miami. Mm-hmm. He has Coach Davis, has them believing in it. They're playing excellent defense. They run the ball very physically. They don't make many turnovers, don't make many mistakes. Solid kicking game. I would not want to play North Carolina out of anybody in that league.
But the two teams that already in that division played North Carolina and defeated them are Virginia and Virginia Tech, so they've got the advantage right now.
Let me reiterate once again. At the present time, I would not want to play North Carolina. I didn't say 3 weeks ago. At the present time.
And that one, and credit to those teams, Virginia beat them in overtime. Virginia Tech had to come from behind. That was a game, if memory serves, when T.J.
Yes.
Yates got hurt, yep. Had Paulus with the issues. So North Carolina is playing well right now. Virginia Tech still have to play each other, so they really just need one more loss.
How about the job that Butch Davis has done in his second year? This is a team last year that lost a lot of close games by 7 points or less, and they turned it around this year. He's done a great job recruiting there. And that's how you turn a program around, with recruiting and coaching. He did a wonderful job of getting the right recruits in.
So would you say that Butch Davis would be a very attractive candidate if you have a job opening?
He could be wearing orange. It could be Clemson, could be Tennessee. Who knows?
On the subject.
I think he's got a great job.
He
I
does.
Think North Carolina is one of the best jobs. Why would you want to leave there? You've
because
got a beautiful area.
Because
beautiful
you can
state.
Go to the best conference in the
where?
Country, the SEC.
Where why go to the SEC? Why go there and play LSU and Spiesburger and Tennessee and Florida?
Because I think the last 2 years, LSU and Florida won the national championships. If you want to be the best, you must play the best and beat the best, and that's the best conference right now.
You want to get to the championship game, the best way to get there is dominate the ACC.
Oh, the best way to get there is go to the Big Ten and not play anybody and
see,
not have a championship
well,
game.
You see what happens when I tried to make a segue? Because, Tennessee was the next highlight. Protect your quarterback, guys. Tennessee and Wyoming. Bill Fulmer, of course, out at the end of the year. Nick Stevens picked off by Mike Newhouse in Wyoming, who is just absolutely dreadful, set up for a touchdown. Wyoming's the worst scoring team in the country. They're averaging like 11 points a game. The one thing you don't want to do is help them. Nick Stevens does again. And after they missed the PAT, Wyoming had outscored its season average in the first quarter and a half, up 13-0 on the Vols. But then Jonathan Crompton came in and replaced Stevens. Crompton to Gerald Jones. Haven't been able to use him as effectively as they had imagined this year, and still in the fourth quarter, Tennessee down 13-7. Now, this is not the way the Volunteers, who were very emotional about the decision to dismiss Phil Fulmer, wanted to send him out. Wyoming defense, which really hasn't stopped anybody, has held Tennessee to 136 yards. And we've been watching this game. The Vols just don't seem into it, Mark.
And if you lost your head coach, a guy that's recruited you, a guy that you spent time with, a guy that you went out and practiced and you sweated and you bled blood for the guy, all of a sudden they fire him. If you're in like your second year or your third year there, when you've got some time left to go, you would be upset. And I think this is affecting those kids.
If you loved him, you played hard before you get to this situation. The situation's over. Just move on.
13-7. Tennessee, by the way, just a little side note, they don't win this game, they can't become bowl eligible. Some of you at the bottom of the hour will see Dabo Swinney and Clemson take on Bobby Bowden. It's coming up. College football presented by cars.com.
College football scoreboard is presented by Acura. Acura Advance. College football scoreboard is presented by Acura. Acura Advance.
Got to move quickly. Western Michigan up, fourth down play. I tried to get you there in time. All right, 23-17. It was a fourth down and 10 attempt for Juice Williams in the red zone against the Broncos of Western Michigan. The pass just went incomplete, and Western Michigan will take over, 48 seconds remaining before they can knock off Illinois in the Big Ten.
What happened to Illinois from the Rose Bowl to possibly no bowl?
Going to fall to 5-5 now.
Mendenhall.
No Mendenhall. Dufresne's been solid, but he hasn't quite been the same throughout the course of the season.
His leadership, his competitiveness.
Very, very true. Very disappointed looking Zook and Juice Williams on the sideline now. Barring a miracle, the Illini will fall to Western Michigan and drop to 5-5. Little Brown Jug game. Just saw it here on ESPN, Michigan and Minnesota. Michigan trying to avoid its first six-game losing streak and eight-loss season. And they came out and they looked a little bit like Michigan. Nick Sheridan to Greg Matthews. Great catch. It led to a Wolverine field goal. There was a lot of Wolverine field goals in the early going. Sheridan slant to Matthews for a touchdown.
Another play to Matthews. But there's no defensive coverage here. When you leave a receiver that open and that much space down in the red zone, it's got to be six.
Michigan jumped on top, 16-0. They had plenty of points. Minnesota, Decker got hurt. That certainly didn't aid the Gopher cause. They fall 29-6. 14th straight win at Minnesota for the Wolverines, and they retain the Little Brown Jug. Utah State, Boise State. Boise State still dreaming of being in a BCS game. Of course, the Utah rally might have hurt their cause a little bit. Kellen Moore to Austin Pettis for 20 yards. That worked so well once on the blue turf, they decided to do it again.
You can't even see the players.
I agree.
It blends right in with the turf.
You can. I mean, how do you know who to cover? Like, that isn't quite fair.
So are you suggesting that they rip up the blue turf in the,
in
the name of fairness?
Wear white pants and blue jersey.
Boise State with a 21-0 lead on Utah State. And the Aggies have won a couple of games, won a couple of conference games, but Boise State's dominant in that league. Georgia and Kentucky, this thing is a wild one in Lexington. No Sean Marino going in to make it 14-0. Appeared it was going to be a blowout, but Cats come back. Tony Dixon scoring to make it 14-7. And here comes Randall Cobb, the young quarterback.
This is the worst defense I've seen at Georgia in many, many years. A school that has a great tradition for defense, just not playing well. Offensively, they're playing that clean.
Matthew Stafford, Sean Chappas, 21-14. Remember how Kentucky couldn't even get off a punt against Florida? Maybe they took notes. They blocked a Georgia punt, mate.
Keep that special teams, coach.
That was Steve Ortmeyer, right? Super Bowl rings, made a tongue-in-cheek against Florida, said that Rich Brooks should fire, and he was kidding. Cobb goes in, 24-21, Cats. Here's No'Shawn answering. This is a terrific run, Mark.
Oh, No'Shawn Marino with the spin move. He's just got so much power and acceleration. If he gets close and you give him a spot, he's going to take it all the way.
28-24, Cats not done. Here's Tony Dixon.
Just going in virtually untouched.
Is defense optional in this game?
Tackling optional. Georgia, I know they've had their goals taken away from them. The offense and No'Shawn playing great. The defense, not so much. This is the Kentucky team that's lost a lot of their weapons. Dickie Lyons is hurt. Derek Locke is hurt. They've changed quarterbacks, and still they're finding ways to score against Georgia. And when it wasn't the offense, it was not only the punt block team, the kickoff return team. Yeah. Winston Guy.
Now, you see what I did with Steve Ortmeyer? I gave him the pep talk a couple weeks ago against Florida, and look how he's responded. How this kickoff return, what a terrific job.
You were totally unfair to him last week, and you're trying to apologize now.
38-35, and the Dogs just fumbled, and Kentucky has it back in Georgia territory with 11.5 to go. Let me tell you something. For a team that was preseason number one and has laid two big-time eggs in their two biggest games of the season, this would be the Wile E. Coyote off the cliff moment for Georgia.
Not only that, how about this Georgia defense giving up 49 to Florida last week and already in this game 38 points, coach? That's just not getting it done.
I think I expressed my views about 2 minutes ago.
I think you said they were awful. 38-35, Cats trying to pull the upset. Arkansas and South Carolina. South Carolina very quietly has improved over the course of the season. Steven Garcia, he's your guy.
Here's the guy. I said once they change to him, running quarterback threat, they are a completely different football team. And they'll give Florida all they want next week.
But they don't have to leave Garcia in. They could put Chris Smelly in to throw a touchdown pass, and they did.
Oh, that's Jared Cook, I believe it is.
It is.
An outstanding tight end. Probably as good as there is in the country.
Hogs had closed within 10-7. Arkansas gave Tulsa its first loss of the season last week. Cook goes in, put Cocky up by 10, and now it's 20-14 as they head to the fourth quarter. Arkansas under Bob Petrino in his first year, they are improving coming down the stretch of the season, Mark.
They definitely are, and this is a team that everybody thought would be awful this year, and they lost a couple of close games, and then they go out and they beat Tulsa, an undefeated team, and now they're battling with South Carolina. He's done a very good job coaching this football.
They have gotten better each and every week. He's an excellent coach, and he and his staff are be congratulated because they look like they have a very good future at Arkansas.
Pittsburgh flexing its muscle, forgetting about the fatigue of the quadruple overtime victory in South Bend last week and hammering Louisville 41-7.
Now that's how you respond off a four overtime victory on the road.
Okay, but let me point this out. Total yards, Pitt has 21 more yards total than Louisville. Five turnovers. That's why when you hear coaches talk about protecting football, playing intelligent, there's a prime example. The two teams have played pretty even, but the score is not indicative of the caliber competition between the two.
35-17, the score on ESPNU. Rutgers fell behind 14-0 to Syracuse. Cameron Dantley's having a rough day. Quarterback for the Orange is 3 of 12, but Mike Teal's thrown three touchdown passes. And Rutgers, which had just an awful start to the season, going to pull to 4-5. Shot to make it to a bowl game. They'll go above 500 in Big East play. Only 3 minutes to go in that one. Of course, sometimes when you get off to those rough starts, as Rutgers did this season, or you've been spiraling out of control all year, as Syracuse has, you just need someone to serve as a sounding board. College football, no one better than Dr. Lou.
Dr. Lou, Dr. Lou, that's Dr. Lou, Dr. Lou, the doctor will see you now. Welcome to Dr. Lou. Be excited about the future. We can solve any problem you have if enough people care. We can solve cancer, poverty, sexism, racism, spousal abuse. We can solve any problem with your football team if enough people care. That's the key. If enough people care, if enough people are willing to subjugate your own welfare for the welfare of the group, we can do anything. Now let's go to our first call.
Dr. Lou, this is Mike Leach, head football coach at Texas Tech. After a win versus Texas, we have gone from being the hunter to the hunted. How do you handle this throughout your career?
Well, not as well as I would like, but congratulations on your great win over Texas. I always told our football team, if what you did yesterday looks big to you, then you haven't done much today. And remember this, every time you win a game, the next game gets even bigger. You won Texas, so that makes your Oklahoma State game exceptionally huge. But if you win this game, then the one against Oklahoma will be even bigger. Every day, Mike, somebody does something great. Today, make that someone be you. Now let's go to our next call.
Hey, Uncle Lou, Mark Wahlberg here. How are you, sir? I was wondering, could you give my beloved Eagles, the Boston College Eagles, any advice to beat your beloved Notre Dame Fighting Irish?
I hear Boston College, I go crazy. 1993, we're 10-0, number one in the country, undefeated. We're playing number 9 Boston College. We lose 41-39 on the last play of the game. I was devastated, I was bitter, I was upset at everybody. Then what I learned is you can't tell people about your problems. 90% don't care, and the other 10% are glad you got them. You can't go through life being bitter. It was like the guy who's in the hospital. He's 86 years of age. He's sick. He's dying. His wife's with him. He said, Ethel, I remember we got married, and I lost my job, and you stayed with me. Then I went into service. You joined the nurses' course. You could be with me. And you were right there with me when I was wounded. And then I went into business 4 times. They all failed, but you were always with me. Here I am in the hospital, 86 years of age, sick, dying.